Welcome to the Undisputed Podcast. I'm your host, Jenny Taft. This podcast is the full show from today's episode of Undisputed from start to finish. We've got a busy slate, so skip Shannon. Let's get to it.
Good morning. Welcome to Undisputed. We are live from Los Angeles. I'm Jenny Taft here with Skip Bayless and Shannon Sharp. How are we doing today, guys?
I'm doing good, dude.
I figured.
You know, I probably today should be wearing a mask and a face shield and a hazmat suit because somebody across from me is about to spew Brady hate all over me.
He did it last night.
Yeah,
he put that on TV. He put that on film. Yeah.
Shannon, you are much too excited about Skip, we're going to get through this today. Let's talk about what we saw last night. The Rams did beat the Buccaneers last night, 27-24, despite rushing for less than 2 yards per carry. Jared Goff picked apart the Tampa secondary for 376 yards and 3 touchdowns, including over 100 yards to both Robert Woods and Cooper Kupp. Meanwhile, Tom Brady finished with 216 passing yards on a season low, 4.5 yards per attempt, and also threw 2 interceptions, including one on the Bucs' final drive when they had a chance to tie or take the lead. The game gave the 43-year-old quarterback Brady his third loss in primetime this season. Shannon, how much was Tom Brady to blame last night?
A lot. 9.5 out of 10. Don't put this in primetime. Tom Brady has played more primetime games. 9 Super Bowls. Is that primetime? 13 AFC championship games. Is that primetime? All these playoff games. Don't put that in primetime. Tom Brady has played bad. It's as simple as that. Tom Brady has not been good this year. He's played
this
good
this year.
Wow. He's played good in spurts.
Oh.
He hasn't put a game together.
Huh.
No, uh-huh.
Did you watch the game at Carolina just a week ago? Is that like a virtuoso masterpiece?
Didn't it come from behind when they 10-9?
Wow.
Okay, huh. Please, let me have my moment. Just let me have my moment. 22 incompletions. Wow. Skip. Yeah. Is that good? You throw the ball 48 times, you have slightly more than 200 yards.
Mm.
Is that good? Is that good or bad?
Mm.
Now, this is what we know here. Brady was inaccurate all night. Last night on the deep balls, 0 for 6 with 2 interceptions on throws 20 yards downfield. Now, Skip Bayless and Pro Football Focus say Tom Brady is doing great throwing the ball down the field. The last 4 games, he's 1 for 20 on throws 20 yards down the field with 3 interceptions. Is that good? Now, here's a stat that somebody, I don't know who came up with this stat. They call it he leads the league. Skip, did you know this?
Mm.
Tom Brady leads the league in 20-yard throws.
Mm.
60. Mm. He leads the league, but he's 27th in completion percentage.
Mm.
4 interceptions, which is 3rd most.
Mm.
Huh.
What was the final score?
Whoa, time out, Skip. Skip, I will let you have your
It was 65-0?
Whoa. If I'm not mistaken. Jenny.
What?
What did I predict the final score was going to be yesterday?
I don't know.
You don't know, Skip.
I have no idea. I don't listen to your scores.
I remember, Shannon.
27-24.
Yes. Right,
did you really?
I really did. Skip Bayless got one right. Skip Bayless said Pro Football Focus also came over the stat. Mm. Air distance. It doesn't matter if the ball is complete or incomplete. I thought completion mattered. Mm. So now it doesn't matter because
because you've been telling me all he does is dink and dunk to his backs.
Skip.
Huh.
What good if I throw the ball? Jeff George would be in the Hall of Fame if completions didn't matter.
I was only refuting your point. He's just a dink and dunker now. That's what you said. He's got no arm. He's a noodle arm. He's a spaghetti wing.
How's his completion percentage when he throws it down the field?
Well, who leads the whole NFL in air distance?
Skip.
And I think he pulled away last night.
Skip, that's an inconsequential stat. Well, you saw him throwing the ball down the field and what it looked like.
Did he dink and dunk last night?
When he didn't dink and dunk, how did he look?
When did he dink and dunk? I saw him dink and dunk to Fournette 3 times and he dropped all 3 of them.
Hold on.
Did you note that over there?
Hold on, time out. He had, Antonio Brown had 13 targets. He had 8 catches for 57 yards. That's 7.1 an attempt. He had 10 targets to Chris Godwin, 7 catches for 53 yards. That's 7.6. He had 1 receiver that had a double-digit average on completion.
Mm.
And you talk about he not dinking and dunking.
Mm. What was the final score?
The final score was Tom Brady lost and the Rams won. That's what, and Jared Goff, first of all, Jared Goff and Sean Payton likely gave this thing away because they got ultra-conservative and they got careless with the football. But
Sean McVay,
excuse me. But Skip, your boy looked awful last night. There's no way around it. I don't want to hear anything about the defense because I told you, everybody based everything. Because, see, if you watch Tampa Bay, everybody wanted to anoint them after they did with Green Bay. And I said, if you watch that defense, I say on the back end, now who said that? I didn't second guess Skip. I told you, I said, Skip, they can be had. I say they're very undisciplined. I say they're out of position a lot more than you think. But because that pass rush covers up, but if they don't get home, they can be had. Whoa, whoa, that defense, they're coming. I'm saying they could be had. Skip, Tom Brady, he got happy feet. He doesn't want to get hit. And they got around, Skip, they really didn't do a whole lot, but they got around him a little bit, and he got like he had poker, hot poker, like he was doing the poker. Skip, you guys, you know what? The thing that's going to happen is they're going to be a wild card, and they're going to go.
Wait a second. After all that, you've got them in the playoffs?
No, hold on, Skip.
You're kidding me.
Hold on.
After all that diatribe, you've got Tom Brady in the playoffs? You said he's awful. He's done. He's washed up. In fact, for four straight years, you have said on this show to open the season, he should go home.
Let me ask you a question. One question. I'm going to turn it over to you. Somebody from the NFC East is going to the playoffs. Are they awful? A simple yes or simple no. Don't explain it. A simple yes or a simple no.
What does that have to do with this conversation?
Tom Brady was awful last night. He still might make the playoffs. That's the point.
That's not a point. That's a terrible point because somebody from the NFC least has to go to the playoffs.
Skip, they added an extra spot.
Nobody from this NFC South has to go because New Orleans is going.
They added an extra spot just so he could get in. They added an extra spot for him.
So you don't have enough guts to predict that Brady and company are out of the playoffs. I want you. I'm putting you on the hot seat.
I predicted.
Hot seat.
I predicted.
Shannon Sharpe's on the hot seat.
I predicted he would play like trash in 2020. I predicted that.
Somebody has no courage of conviction.
What they got to do with last
Somebody's
night?
Somebody's got no guts.
What they
got
to do with last night?
Put your money where your mouth
did.
Is.
I predicted he would play like trash in 2020.
Oh, did you?
I'm being prophetic right now.
And yet, through the first eight games, he led the league in big-time throws. That's trash. Oh, that's trash. Way to go. All right, is it my turn finally? Is the show over yet? I don't know. Are we still on the air?
You got plenty of time.
Oh, good.
I don't know what you're going to talk about.
I'm going to need plenty of time. So, as usual, I first guessed everything that was going to happen last night because I told you on the air, you can look it up, you can pull the tape, yesterday, this was an awful matchup for Tom Brady because the Rams have one of the most fierce pass rushes in pro football. Wouldn't you agree with that?
Yes.
Because what do you tell me about Aaron Donald? He's transcendent. He's one of the greatest defensive linemen in the history of football. He's the most valuable player in the entire league, says the Hall of Famer Shannon Sharpe. Am I right about that?
That was years ago. Mahomes, the best player right now.
Oh, years ago on Aaron Donald? I think it might have been 2 years ago. Okay. By the way, just for the record, Aaron Donald, do you have any stats on him from last night? Help me out. Do you have any?
Did they double and triple him?
I'm sure they did. Okay. But if you're Reggie White, if you're Lawrence Taylor, it doesn't matter how many people try to block you. You create stats because you get to the quarterback. And by the way, Aaron Donald last night, here are his stats across the board. He's not on the stat sheet because he didn't register. He had nothing. He had no tackles. He had no tackles for losses, obviously. He had no sacks. He had no quarterback hits. He had no sacks. He had no nothing. Aaron Donald, the man that Shannon Sharpe says he's at least the second best player in pro football. But
he's
now we're back to what happened last night.
Yeah, what happened last night?
So I told you the Rams can rush four and get home. And they got home, especially in the third quarter. And they knocked the hell out of Tom Brady. He took some serious abuse, especially in the third and early in the fourth quarter. And I will agree with you, he got a little gun shy late in the game. And he got happy footed just like all humans do when they get the hell kicked out of
him. Those don't do that.
Okay, yeah, well, he's a 43-year-old GOAT, and he's still playing at an extremely high level. But he knows how to survive and just sort of stay the course, and that's by not getting hit the way Drew Brees got hit and broke, like, 17 ribs, right? Okay, so now you've got not only this pass rush coming after you with four, you might have the best cornerback duo in all of football right now, Jalen Ramsey and Darius Williams, and they were playing at an all-pro level last night because Darius Williams did an extraordinary job on Antonio Brown. He had him the whole night, and obviously it was big time versus big time. It was all night long. It was Jalen Ramsey versus Mike Evans, and he also did an extraordinary job on Mike Evans, especially in the fourth quarter because he basically took him away from Tom Brady. That's a tough matchup because I told you it's going to have to be a Rojo game. The last thing I said at the end of the show yesterday, it's got to be a Ronald Jones game. huh, let me see. What did Ronald Jones do here? Oh, he carried it 10 times for 24 yards. So at Carolina, he had a 98-yard run, right, for a touchdown. 10 times for 24 yards, that's 2.4 a try. And for the team, they had 18 rushes for 42 yards. That's 2.3 yards per try, all of which adds up to Tom Brady was in big trouble. Now we get to the defense. We have seen back-to-back primetime games in that stadium. We saw a Sunday night game against Drew Brees and now a Monday night game against Jared Goff.
Got another one coming, too.
That's exactly right. And they are going to get run off the field by Patrick Mahomes and company. This defense is terrible. I am here to tell you, this defense will take this team nowhere in the playoffs. Brady or no Brady, it just doesn't matter if you cannot defend the pass, and they cannot defend the pass. So guess what we've seen? We saw Drew Brees come in and light them up. And if we just take the combined passes, Taysom Hill threw some passes also in that game. But if we take Drew Brees, Taysom Hill, and then what happened with Jared Goff last night, those three passers in these last two primetime home games at Tampa completed nearly 80% of their passes. Okay, what's going to happen? You're going to lose because you can't stop anybody. And I know the theme of the night was, well, Tampa can really stop the run. Nobody can run on Tampa. Nobody wants to run on Tampa because it's ridiculous. It's too easy to throw on Tampa because they are sitting ducks.
Right.
They got two young corners, as you point out. They got a rookie safety. And I don't know what's happened to the pass rush. They did not touch Jared Goff last night. His jersey was as clean as a whistle, and we're going to get to this later. It stayed clean after the game because Tom Brady wasn't there to shake his hand, right?
What?
We're going to get to that, but that's called vintage Tom Brady. But the point was, Jared Goff, he unravels as quickly as any quarterback in the league. He had four turnovers in the first half at Miami just about a month ago, right?
Right.
You have to get him early, and Todd Bowles, I'm so disappointed in because he's such a creative blitzer. They come from everywhere in any way, shape, and form. And you got the athletes to blitz because you got two inside linebackers who can come after you from everywhere.
Well, Skip, did you see what they were doing? They took the clock down. They were under 5 seconds because they wanted him to show where he was coming from.
And McVay was really good at
it.
And they had a great plan with a lot of quick screens and a lot of hot routes.
Right.
It was just it was all dinking and dunking.
Right.
And when they did blitz, which was not often enough, they blitzed on the very first play of the game, and then the whole rest of the first half, they didn't blitz one time. I was out of my mind because you have to light him up. If you can knock him down a couple of times, you can get to him psychologically.
When they tried to, Skip, right before the end of the half, and they caught him with the jailbreak screen, and Robert Woods almost got out the house on it.
Yep.
So because, as you mentioned, because they run so many bubble screens, you got to be careful blitzing because they let you through. They got two tackles. They got two linemen pulling, and they got wide receivers blocking.
Yep.
The guy going to hit his head on the goalpost.
Okay.
So that scared Todd Bowles out of blitzing.
All right. So meanwhile, in the first half, Tom Brady is playing one of his better halves of the whole year. So he came out in prime time after stinking it up before at Chicago and versus New Orleans at home on Sunday night. He came out and threw the heck out of the football in the first half. And that drive that put them ahead 14-7, it came mid-second quarter.
Mm-hmm.
If we could see the completions in this drive, these are third down completions. It starts with a 3rd and 6, and that goes to Cameron Brate, who is becoming one of his most trusted receivers. And here's a 3rd and 9. That's 3rd and 9. That's a rocket shot on the button. And here we go with a 3rd and 8. And this is a little Scotty Miller, and that was his best throw of the night, and that was pass interference because the safety who picked him off twice, Jordan Fuller from Ohio State, the rookie, got there early, and then he threw an 18-yarder to Mike Evans that got them down to the 2. He was on fire in this drive, and this team should have been, again, Jared Goff went down and tied at 14-14, but the play of the night for me, as far as me rooting for the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, came late in the first half. It's 19 seconds left, and they've got the Rams backed up. They've got them where they want them, and all of a sudden, they run a little wide receiver screen to Robert Woods. This is horrible. And he gets loose, and they don't have time. The clock is tick, 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 ticking, and he just says, no, I'm going to go as far as I can and hope we can spike it, and they got it done. That is a 40-yard gain. It was just terrible. Yeah, 35 yards. Okay. 35-yard gain down to the 20-yard line. And gave them the field goal that I think was the difference in the football game. And by the way, in the McVay regime, they are now 32-0 when leading at halftime. Well, that puts them into 32 range, right?
Pretty good.
So there you go. In the second half, all of a sudden that pass rush started getting to Brady and he started getting hit. And to your point, he was horrible in the third quarter, but he came back to life and had a nice drive in the fourth quarter to tie the game at 24. But here's the play of the night for Tom Brady. He is in a slump, as you correctly point out, throwing the deep ball. But with 7:17 left in the game, he goes deep to Antonio Brown. This is the play of the night that did not work for the Bucs. It's a very near miss, if we could see it. This changes the game. He throws it deep to Antonio, and it's almost, it's just off his fingertips. If they connect on that, and Antonio scores, or at least has it all the way down to 20. This is the play of the night, and they are inches off. It was a good throw. Antonio's a small man, and he couldn't quite get there. If that connects, I think all hell breaks loose for the Rams, because that would have been the play that opened Pandora's box.
Skip, what's happening is, if you watch the Bucs, last night they ran basically two things. It was hard play action and the quick game. And I tweeted, if a team is running the quick game, you got to press somewhere. Skip, you can't allow receivers just to go down and set up. And you notice Williams started pressing Antonio Brown.
Yep.
You saw Jalen Ramsey. Eventually, he started pressing Mike Evans. Because those are the two guys. I don't believe Chris Godwin can consistently beat me. I know those other two guys can consistently beat me.
That's what they said last night.
Yep. So that's the way I would have approached it.
Yep.
And so now, all of a sudden, all I need Brady to do, if I got to make him take his first read away. So whomever that is, if that's Antonio Brown, I need to take him away because I need him to bring the ball down a little bit. If that's Mike Evans, I need him to bring the ball down a little bit. And they did that, Skip. And because they couldn't run the football, Brady needs the run, Skip. He needs that.
But most of them do. Most humans.
My homeboy don't. My homeboy. So can we put the rest now, Skip? Can we put this to bed now that Tom Brady has had his good pro football focus? Everybody should just throw this in the trash because they said Tom Brady was playing better than Patrick Mahomes.
Just a week ago, they said that.
I needed them to grade my papers in high school. I'd have been valedictorian like you. Mm. Yep. But unfortunately, they were not grading my paper. But Skip, look, I want to show you something because I don't like to do this. But I want to show you some of Tom Brady's throws that he had that you said was so good because that one that was really, really close, he had some that was really, really far away. Hey, Jim, drop that track for me right quick. Now, I want to know who do you think this is going to be complete to. Out of bounds.
Well, you know what? I think he threw it over the left shoulder.
Out of bounds, though.
He could have caught that over the left shoulder.
That should have been intercepted, right? What is this, Skip? Who is that one to?
Okay, timeout. Can we go over that play, or are you going to show another one?
I'm going to show another one. Okay. Because I got plenty of them. Who is this one to, Skip?
Well, obviously, that's the last play of the game. We're about to get to that. I'm about to get all over that game.
Skip. I mean, look at this one, Skip. That's out of bounds.
Okay, that's not out of bounds. Mike Evans turns and looks over his right shoulder instead of his left shoulder.
Okay, wait a look up at this one.
Which one was it?
That was up the right rail when 43 should have had three interceptions.
Okay, he did. It was an overthrow.
And I want you to know.
You know what? And you keep saying he's a noodle arm, and all these throws are missing long. They're not missing short. They're long, all of them.
And they let him off the hook. You know and I know that was a fumble in the end zone. When Tom Brady's arm came, ball was empty.
Ball's coming forward.
No, Skip, Skip, the ball is out of his hand. Look at this. Skip, the ball is out. Look at that. The ball's out.
Boy, I thought it was a forward pass.
No. Look at Skip. How's that a fumble back?
He's throwing it. It's coming out of the palm of his hand. It's coming forward.
Skip. That ball,
well, you couldn't finish the throw because his arm's being held.
Exactly. Okay, and the ball slips out.
But it starts forward in his arm, and it's a forward pass.
Skip, if the ball slips out, but never, you know what? The guy said, you know what? We're not going to let you off the hook like the tuck rule bailed out.
Let's go back to the first interception.
Let's go back to it.
It's a rare Ram blitz by Justin Hollins, the outside linebacker who's 6 feet, 5 inches tall. And Justin Hollins is in Brady's face and I think rakes across the front of him. Did you see that?
Yeah.
Okay, he's all over him. And hits his arm and body, and the ball just goes sideways.
But, Skip, even if it doesn't
go sideways, he's trying to step into it, and it just goes sideways.
But if he steps into it, The guy's still going to pick it. The guy's in the hole.
Nope, the ball goes just wobbles left. So it just goes sideways out of his hand.
But let me ask you. There's
no direction to it at all.
So let me ask you a question. Was he throwing that ball to Chris Godwin?
He's throwing it to the right side. I don't know who was running up the right rail. But,
Skip.
Okay.
That's Godwin.
His arm gets hit.
But, Skip, if he's throwing it to Godwin, he's doubled.
Okay. But the point is, I'd like to see the throw without the arm and the face getting hit.
But why would he even throw it that direction if the guy's doubled?
Okay, he's trying to throw it, and look, I can't see the completion of the pass. I don't know where it was headed.
Skip.
It gets knocked sideways.
Skip, there's no one down there but Chris Godwin.
Well, who knows?
There's him, and there's a guy with his shoulder.
I can't speak to that.
Okay, right here. Where is he throwing it to?
I don't know. It goes sideways. I'm not sure. It came sideways out of his hand. He gets hit. It's a blitzer right in his face who just rakes him he's trying to step into it.
I get that. But why is he throwing it to a guy that's double?
I don't know. I have no idea.
Okay.
And it's for you criticizing the guy who has six game-winning drives to win six
That
rings.
Wasn't a Super Bowl. That got nothing to do. Okay. He did that. I'm talking about last night.
He has the all-time most game-winning drives in the fourth quarter in the history of this league.
What about last night?
Okay, so last night, that last drive starts off with he hits Cameron Brate for 7 yards and he hits Chris Godwin for 12 yards, and I'm thinking, okay, here we go. And then his favorite clutch receiver has become the backup tight end, Cameron Brate.
Yeah.
So he sees him up the seam with the step. And he said after the game, it was a bad read and a bad throw. Well, it's not even a bad read. It's just a bad throw because he thought he could force it in to Cameron Brate, who has a step on, I don't know who, 40, is it Johnson? I think he's a step on the safety, 43. But the other safety just sitting back there,
it's single high safety.
Yeah. And it's the rookie Fuller.
Yes.
And he's just sitting back there, but Brady's going to have to force it into Cameron Brate. And if he hits him, we got a field goal set up already. Not to mention, it's 1:56 left.
Yeah.
But he just airmails him. It's just a bad throw. A bad throw.
That ain't ever. Mahomes not even fitting that one in.
Well, he tried.
Yeah, but Skip, first of all, he got the guy in the trail technique, and the guy's in the hole. You can't fit that in.
No, he can't. And so he tried it, and I think at the last second, he's like, I don't know, and he tries to throw it high and hard, and he just airmailed him.
He ain't got no high and hard.
It's a bad idea.
He ain't got no high and hard.
You saw that throw to Scotty Miller. That was high and hard.
Well, he should have saved that one for that throw right there, and that would have got picked.
Okay, but he knew as soon as it left his hand, it's just a bad idea because it looked like Fuller was the primary receiver on the play, right?
So can we, Skip, all that's fine. Okay. Can we just say he played bad last night?
No, I don't think he played bad overall.
Come on, Skip.
I just showed you what he did in the first half. He was outstanding
in the first half.
He was dealing in the first half.
But Skip, no, he was not.
And in fact, they won the fourth quarter 7-3, and he did have a game time drive in the middle of the fourth quarter. Does that count?
Skip.
Does it count?
Skip. I didn't even.
Did he do that?
First of all, Skip, I didn't want to bore the people at home with all the incompletions that he had to AB in the first half and all the overthrows to Mike Evans. Come on, Skip.
The Rams are number one in the National Football League in yards allowed.
But give him any credit?
Is there any degree of difficulty?
But you say he to go.
Okay. We saw Patrick Mahomes have a hard time beating the Raiders at the Raiders the other night. Did you see what Brady did to the Raiders Raiders?
Hold on.
He threw a party on them, a Las Vegas
party.
But guess
who's number two in defense? The Indianapolis Colts. But they beat Aaron Rodgers. You didn't give Rodgers no break. Okay, Tom Brady. Tom Brady's the GOAT.
But Aaron Rodgers had a 28-14 lead at halftime, and just he unravels. What I tell you, it's like he folds like a Tampa lawn chair at a retirement community.
This is what we know. This is what we know about your guy. When it goes bad, when it goes to hell, it goes to hell in a handbasket.
We
saw him against New Orleans twice. We saw him against Chicago, and we saw him last night.
Yep.
Now, can we put this to bed that he's in the MVP discussion, and he's playing better than Mahomes, he's playing better than Russ.
I didn't say that. Pro Football Focus said that.
But you follow it up. Yeah. You've been following. Oh, he graded higher than nobody thinks that.
Prisoner of moment. He had a bad game by his standards last night. I'll give you that.
Skip. Tell me the game in which Mahomes has had that's worse than any of the before losses for Tom Brady. Tell the game. Even though he lost to the Raiders, he threw for 340 and two touchdowns.
Yep.
Tom Brady stunk it up four times.
Tom Brady doesn't have Travis Kelce and the fastest receiver in pro football.
Whoa.
Tyreek.
Hold on. You told me he got the GOAT tight end. He got Mike Evans, Chris Godwin, two Pro Bowl players. He got A.B., who's on the Hall of Fame art. He got all that.
How many years has Mahomes been playing with those two receivers?
Whoa. Mahomes, this is only his third year starting. Brady the GOAT.
4 years he's been playing.
What about
with
all those game-winning drives in the Super Bowl?
What about him?
Exactly. You don't want to mention that now. Now, all of a sudden, how long have you been playing with those guys? No. Skip, he played.
We're in the middle of a pandemic. There were no preseason games. There were no OTAs.
There was no preseason for anybody.
On the fly. Well, he's the one guy who didn't. He's got a brand new team. He's had no experience with any of these people.
No mercy.
Montrezl Harrell spoke with the media yesterday for the first time since leaving the Clippers for the Lakers. The reigning sixth man of the year said joining the Lakers was a, quote, business decision. And when he was asked if the Clippers wanted him back, he replied, obviously, it doesn't seem that way, does it? Shannon, what does this tell you?
Yeah, I think the biggest thing is that maybe the Clippers, Trez didn't feel like the Clippers made him a priority. He's like, I'm the sixth man of the year, and here we are a couple of days into it. You would like to think, Skip, they probably had been having conversations with Rich Paul at some point in time and says, okay, yes, we want to bring him back. This is what we're looking to pay. What are you looking for? Maybe Trez's personality, Skip. When you come up like Trez wasn't, I don't even know if he was drafted. But when you come up like he did, scrapping and trying to fight, play hard, practice hard every single game. You bring Kawhi and Paul George in there, and he's out there practicing on the court, and those guys are sitting on the sideline, or those guys are missing games. That's going to rub him the wrong way. And it looks to me from the outside, and like I said, I don't know, it looks like from the outside looking in, Skip, that's not going to change. Kawhi and Paul George, those are superstars. Moving forward, they're probably going to take practices off. They're probably going to take games off. And it was easier to move, let Trez go via free agency as opposed to have that conflict and to run it back. So that's what it looks like to me, Skip. Now, I could be totally off base with this, but it seems to me, because we heard rumblings after the season, they were upset that guys missing was practicing when they wanted to, guys playing when they wanted to, and that rubbed some in the locker room. If I had to guess, it would probably be Trez that would be rubbed the wrong way. And so, Skip, but this is a good deal for Trez. And if you look at it, Skip, Trez, Serge Ibaka, and Double T basically got the same deal, the mid-level exception with a second-year option, whether it's a team or a player option. That's what they got. Shooters got the money. Bertans, look what he got. Bogdan from Sacramento, he signed that big offer sheet. The big, Skip, really didn't get the money. Because they're not shooting, they're putting a premium on shooting the threes. And so, Skip, I like the Lakers getting Trez because I believe they're getting a guy that's extremely motivated. He didn't play his best basketball when the season resumed. Let's not sugarcoat that. There's facts, Skip. He didn't play once he got to the bubble, and maybe his grandmother, he had a lot on his mind. He didn't come back with the same ferocity that he had when he left. Because up until that point, Skip, he was a monster. And when he came back, he wasn't that. But it didn't feel like, and it to him, because it all that matters to him, he didn't feel like the Clippers prioritized him, or they didn't give him the indication that they wanted him back as much as he thought he should have been wanted back. So he says, okay, I'll make a business decision. They got this over there. I want, like you said, Rondo, he wasn't going to have to move. He went to the Clippers. Trey says, hey, I ain't got to move. Well, he might have to now because one of them plied Biff and the other's in the El Segundo. So he might go on down there to the marina, which is nicer than Playa anyway, but it's close by.
So when I read this story yesterday, I must admit I laughed and laughed and laughed some more because I had to put up with your gloating for two and a half hours.
What I gloat about?
We got Trez. We stole him from the Clippers. No, you didn't steal him from the Clippers. The Clippers didn't want him back. And I'm going to go one more step than you went. It wasn't like they were negotiating or the money wasn't right. I believe from all I've read and heard, they just didn't want him, period.
Yes.
They knew they had a great shot at Serge Ibaka, and they decided that Serge was an upgrade over Montrezl Harrell on the court and especially in the locker room. Because what do we know about Serge? Well, he's coming off a breakout year, his career year, when a breakout year, but a career year in Toronto, averaging 15 and 8, shooting 39% in the regular season from three. So he's a floor spacer. They want to be able to space the floor more. Montrez doesn't shoot threes.
Right.
Okay. So what do we know about Serge and Kawhi? Well, Serge has a little YouTube show called How Hungry Are You?
Oh, yeah.
And the first time I ever saw Kawhi Leonard speak public, the first time after all those years, I loved him. He's my favorite player in San Antonio. He never spoke.
No.
He wouldn't speak after games, even to the local TV network in San Antonio. He would not speak.
But when he did speak, it was like pulling teeth.
you just got nothing. But he never did an appearance anywhere.
Right, right.
And early on in his Toronto run, he agreed to go on How Hungry Are You with Serge. And it's in the kitchen. They're cooking, eating, I don't know. And he's like ribbing him, you know, right. like prodding him.
Right.
What about this? You know, what about your personal life? What about your private life? And he could get away with it because he's Serge
right.
and they're buddies.
Right.
And then the classic video of Kawhi Leonard in the back of a limo during the free agency period was, what'd it do, baby? Well, guess who shot that?
Serge. Right.
Serge is right there with
right.
him. And Serge was the one who posted it.
Right.
So I don't know this for a fact, but I'm going to assume that Serge and Kawhi, pretty good friends, maybe very close. Mm-hmm. And so if Kawhi does
have... As close as someone can get to Kawhi.
That is correct. So if Kawhi has the kind of pull that I think he does, it may not be LeBron-esque, but it's up in the ballpark, well, then I would think he would push for, hey, we got a chance to bring in a really good guy that everybody will like, and he can actually shoot. And it sounds like they just said, good, we're out on Montrez.
I believe the second part of what you said, because Serge and Kawhi Leonard's personality will mesh better in the locker room, that wasn't going away. Kawhi's probably going to miss practice time, Skip. He's probably, what did you say, 13, 14 back-to-backs?
Mm-hmm.
He's probably going to miss some games. That's not going to... Serge is used to that, because guess what? Serge saw it up close and personal in Toronto. So that's not going to bother him.
Nope.
If it bothered Trez last year, it was going to bother him again this year.
Mm-hmm.
And Skip, the thing is that Kawhi's personality is fine as long as you're winning. When you don't win, it's not good enough to say, I'm just doing my job. Mm-hmm. You're going to have to be the voice to hold people accountable. And that's not him. Kawhi, the type of guy, Skip, just from observing him, I'm going to go do my job. You do your job. Well, things are not going well, Skip. You're going to need somebody. Hey, we need to have a team meeting. Hey, bro, look here.
All right.
That's not him.
I got it. So to your point, Montrez and Lou Williams had been there for 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
They were the heart and soul of the Clippers.
Yes.
And all of a sudden, here come two premier free agents,
right.
Kawhi, Paul George. Wait a second. And remember all the way back to January, Montrez was the first one to speak out and call out the team for lack of effort.
Right.
And it seemed to be centered maybe on the newcomers,
yes.
right?
Yes.
And that didn't probably go over too well in the locker room.
Right.
And then there was a clash, according to our man Chris Haynes on Yahoo, that during game two of the Denver series that they got into it, Montrez and Paul George
yes.
got into it.
Yes.
And it was back and forth about what was the line. Trez, according to Chris, said, you're always right. Nobody can ever tell you differently. And they had very heated words,
right.
profane words.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure somebody upstairs going all the way up to Mr. Ballmer said, this is not acceptable,
right?
Right? So when Montrez became a defensive liability, especially against the Denver Nuggets, I think they just sat back and said, okay, enough is enough. I know he's the sixth man of the year, but we have a chance to maybe even upgrade, certainly in fit, in unity fit with Serge Ibaka.
I can't wait to see Serge try to bang down with Yoke on the block. I mean, that's going to be very interesting.
Okay. Well,
because ain't no shame in getting tore up by Yoke. Because
okay.
Yoke's the real deal.
Well, Yoke tore up Montrez because in the minutes he was in, it was just a mismatch.
Guess what? He going to tear up Serge Ibaka, too.
Okay. I like Serge's chances at 7 feet over Montrez's chances at, I don't know what he is, 6'6" or 7".
Skip, he ain't got enough bricks in his back pocket. Mm-hmm. But like you said, because of what Trez outspokenness, and it's when you got superstar, Skip, it's kind of hard to get one of those guys because, first of all, Skip, you know, they signed 2-1. So after this year, they're free. They can go, but they got player options. And you can let Trez go and be okay. You let one of these guys go, you're not getting back the compensation, or it'll ruin your team. Because you got to think about it now. You want to keep Kawhi and Paul George. so they can be going to that new building. Now, whenever that's going to be up, they get, you know, they closed on the old farm. But you keep saying they didn't want Trez. They didn't want Trez. They wanted Serge Ibaka. So did they choose not to sign Rondo? Or he chose to go elsewhere.
He chose to go elsewhere.
Okay, then.
Well, he chose not to be a Laker or a Clipper.
Skip, first of all, we made the decision that we got early indication. We would have loved to have Rondo back, but not at 2 years, $15 million guaranteed. Mm. We're going to take Schroeder, 27. That's what we did.
Okay.
We got better.
Well, good luck to you.
Yeah, well,
we got worse.
Look is what happened when preparation meets opportunity. Mm-hmm. Did you see LeBron's video last night? Already in the weight room. Already in the room. Don't do this. Don't roll your eyes, Skip. That's so unbecoming of you. Cause go do things. Go repeat. Repeat.
What does he have to keep showing people?
The same reason Tom Brady be showing people that he on the beach and he be throwing. He up there in Jackson. The same reason. That's why.
But Brady's the GOAT.
What kind of GOAT that was last night?
He's still the GOAT.
And what kind of GOAT?
He's already proven to be the GOAT, unquestionably.
No, Skip. At one point in time, I had 850 credit. Mm. It's 800 now. Mm. I'm trying to get it back to 850. Mm. Okay, you got to get back to that GOAT status. You don't get to have that for lifetime.
Yeah, you do.
You update your... No. In pro sports, we update resumes. We update resumes here in pro sports now. Okay. I don't know how they do it in their business.
So Mahomes has one lucky Super Bowl win in which he threw a late third quarter interception and an early fourth quarter interception and got away with throwing a punt to Tyreek that saved the game.
Guess what? If he send his resume in right now, best quarterback in the NFL is at the top of the list. If Tom Brady sent his resume in, hot fresh off of hot air, that's right at the top of the list.
Well, Mahomes is only 5 Super Bowls short of Tom Brady, so good luck.
No. I'm saying right now, he better, but we're going to get back on topic. Trez didn't feel appreciated. Maybe you're right. Maybe they wanted to move in a different direction. But we love to have people that motivated. Like we got Dwight Howard. Was motivated. We got an Anthony Davis because y'all said he wasn't that dog. Charles Barkley said, I don't know if he got that dog in him. I love getting guys that motivated. You get that guy right there. He built the right stuff. Y'all in a heap of trouble.
Clippers don't think he was built to any stuff, long stuff.
That's funny how everybody said Trez, that dog, Lou Will, Pat Bev, that's them dogs. Now, the moment he don't go back to the Clippers, he not made of the right stuff. He not ready to the right stuff. LeBron James, I don't know if LeBron James could do it. The moment he does it, they were more mentioned. The Clippers didn't want to be in the bubble. They didn't want to be there. You don't want any time there's a chance to go compete for a title. How do you pass that up?
Trez was bubble trouble for the Clippers.
No.
And the Lakers stayed together. Way to go, LeBron.
Hold
Congratulations.
No, Skip. No. So we going to gloss over the Kawhi down the stretch in the fourth quarters? Are we going to gloss over Paul George hitting the side of the backboard in the fourth quarter?
They were terrible.
Pandemic P? P-E-E? We going to gloss over that? So that's Trez. Your superstars got to be superstars, and your role players do their role.
I should have known when the sixth man of the year is signed for a grand total of $9.3 million this year and $9.7 next year, you should know the league is kind of saying no to Montrez.
Skip.
That's all you can get?
Skip, sixth man of the year is not MVP. That's not MVP.
Well, obviously not.
Look, there are some contracts that got signed that we don't know how and why. But sometimes people make bad decisions because your guy is the GOAT in two different areas. Bad GM, and you say he the GOAT player, but he's equally GOATish in the other one. Would you agree with that?
I would agree with that, but I would also agree that Serge Ibaka is better than Montrezl
Harrell. Well, we're going to find out.
Yep.
There ain't number one way to do it.
In fact, I think Serge was the centerpiece of all free agency. It was the biggest, best signing anybody had in free agency.
You would say that.
I would.
You out your mind.
It's true.
You out your mind.
Leave it at that.
But you know what? December 22nd, we're going to toss the ball up in the air.
And we're going to spoil the party.
After y'all watch that banner come down.
The banner. Shannon, you've got how many days until we can move on from last year's championship? Guys, Mike McCarthy had an interesting way to get his team inspired before, upsetting the Vikings on Sunday. McCarthy brought several watermelons on the trip to Minnesota, and he spent the team's meeting the night before the game smashing them with a sledgehammer like 80s prop comic Gallagher. The scene culminated with DeMarcus Lawrence smashing a watermelon with Delvin Cook's picture on it. McCarthy told reporters Monday it's important to have fun. The players were into it. So, Shannon, did you like this as a motivational tactic? Have you done this before?
Hell no. I don't think it's fun. And listen, dear white America, anytime you have black people in your presence, watermelon has a negative connotation.
Yep.
Let it go. Mm. Let it go. Things that were acceptable many, many years ago, even though it wasn't acceptable, it was tolerated, is unacceptable. It will not be tolerated. Find another tool, another mechanism to motivate your players, black players. If you need somebody, a white man, smashing watermelon to get you motivated, you're in the wrong line of business. Mm. It's not funny. It's not cute. I don't get these young guys anymore. I really don't. Because ain't no way in hell Mike Shanahan, Dan Reeves, Wade Phillips, or any of my coaches could have ever brought a watermelon. And what? And you think that's cool? And he bragged about it. Hey, we're going to keep this on the hush. Mm-hmm. He openly talking about it.
He did.
First of all, when I saw the watermelon, coach, what you doing with that? If you ain't going to a picnic, if you ain't going to a cookout or a barbecue, man, you better not have no watermelons coming up in there talking about we smashing this. I don't know what Mike McCarthy was thinking. And I don't know what those black players in the locker room was thinking allowed him to do that bullshit.
Agreed.
Man. And then you got Joe Looney, Tony Pollard.
They're captains.
And then
along with Sean Lee. So two of the three captains are African-American. Did they object? Did they raise an objection?
Hell no. Ain't nobody objected. Like, oh, yeah, we're going to be motivated. I don't think they get the gravity of how ridiculous they look and the connotation that comes along with blacks and watermelon. But guess what? You won a game, so I guess it's all cool. Next thing they let you, they gonna bring some, next thing they gonna know and sit you out of a table of fried chicken and have at it, fellas. Y'all, boy, y'all look here. Skip Bayless and sports, we need to stop all this old buck dancing that we be doing. I'm so disappointed in the black players for the Dallas Cowboys that they would allow this to happen. I'm so disappointed. This ain't about no motivation. Do you get what they done? They used to throw watermelons at black people. And y'all out there, y'all think it's cute. You up there smashing it. And D-Law probably hit it about 5 or 6 times, too.
That was the one with Dalvin Cook's face.
Yeah, he probably hit it 5 or 6 times. Mm-hmm. Little do they know what they think about
it. Well, is that the point? Do they know? Maybe these black players are from a different era. Were they raised differently than you were raised in rural South Georgia? Is it an age difference? Is it?
It is, Skip. But the connotation for watermelon and fried chicken never goes away.
I agree.
It never goes away.
Yeah, I consider both racist symbols.
Thank you.
They are. And we just went through a period of Black Lives Matter in which we tried to eradicate all the racist symbols, mostly in the form of statues, remaining in this country. And it seemed like we wiped out many of them, but you can't wipe out watermelons because people do still like to eat watermelons. But when you start to smash watermelons in front of a team, I don't know exactly what their racial breakdown
is. At least 65%.
65? Could be 70, somewhere in that.
Because the NFL is between 68 and 70% African American. So the Cowboys, I would say that makeup is at least that, Skip.
Okay. So USA Today quotes a Cowboys source, I assume one of the players, and I don't know if it's a black or a white player, saying that everybody was laughing so hard, it was entertaining to say the least. Okay. Is that what every black player thought in that room? I don't know. Will we hear any backlash starting what is today? Tuesday, but it'll start tomorrow when there be some media availability.
Yeah.
Will any of the black players stand up and say, you know what, that was out of line?
Think about how many people used to laugh when the white comedians dressed up in blackface. Yeah. People were laughing. Just because someone laughed, that don't mean it's okay.
Yeah. Obviously, I don't believe Mike McCarthy intended this as some sort of racist slight. He'd be out of his mind. But he also was very insensitive to what that stands for when you have a team that's 65-70% black.
Exactly.
Right? So it was his brilliant idea to take the watermelons on the team plane, because you can't get watermelons right now up in Minneapolis because they're not in season, obviously. So they cart them up there in the team plane, and he found a sledgehammer that would work to smash. And it's a little bit of a playoff. I don't know if McCarthy knew that comedian Gallagher back in the 80s. He used to end his act, or I don't know, I never watched his act, but he would smash watermelons, right? And McCarthy said he was a little concerned. The hotel was very concerned because it's going to make the biggest mess in whatever meeting room they were in. But he said we were very efficient and we had quick cleanup of it and it worked. And it obviously worked for them on the field because they did come out and play their most inspired football of the season, isn't saying much, but they did.
Well, if it takes someone doing something insensitive, racially insensitive, to motivate you, hey, okay. I guess you.
And we didn't talk about this, but he also tried another sort of motivational strategic tactic, which was called across the hall. And I'd never heard of these kind of sessions exactly this way, where everybody traded sessions, where the receivers went over to the cornerbacks coach, whoever's coaching the DBs. Yes. And, everybody mixed and matched meeting rooms.
Well, that's what Coach Belichick did so well with Tom Brady.
That's one-on-one. Right. That was basically the defensive coach telling the quarterback to look for.
I'm surprised that more players, because I always, if I line up here, I'm always asking the corners and safeties, if I line up here, tell me what you think I'm running. If I line up here, if I do this, okay, they were like, Sharp, why did you do this? Well, if you line up here and I'm looking at the front, I know you're in this cover.
I got it. That's informal. These were formal sessions where they walked across the hall and traded meeting rooms. Whatever it takes, they were 2-7.
Don't you think you should?
Yep. You should do that on your own.
Thank you.
I got it. But this was a tactic I'd never really, in all my years covering pro football, I'd never heard of that before. Obviously, Belichick would counsel Brady.
Right.
And you would go seek counsel.
Right. Because I needed to know if you jump, did I tip the rod off? Right. Am I tipping the rod off? Am I doing this? And so you need to know, the DBs, ask outside, if you see me line up here, where am I weak? Where am I vulnerable?
Yep. So McCarthy was asked yesterday, so are you going to try the watermelon motivational tactic again before Washington, which comes on Thanksgiving, so it's coming immediately here. And he said, that's a great question. We'll see, blah, blah, blah. Well, I'm hoping after what you just said that he nixes that idea.
They need
idea.
To be done with the watermelons.
Yes.
Unless they're eating it for a picnic or cookout.
Yeah. Well, the point is that I would hope that Washington in and of itself would be enough motivation. Listen, I grew up covering the Cowboys in this business this is back in the good old days.
Yes.
When Dallas Washington week, the last thing you needed was motivation. It was all out blood hatred.
Think of what you said. Yeah. You said that was the only time Raider week.
Yeah, Raider week.
It's Raider week.
Yeah.
Do nothing else need to be said. Ain't need to give no pep talks. Ain't need no promote. Ain't need no dummies, no nothing.
Mm-mm.
It was Raiders week. Mm-mm. We were geeked.
You just are.
geeked.
Right. And wouldn't this team be geeked after it went to Washington and just got its butt kicked?
Yes.
It was 25-3. And remember, Andy Dalton got knocked out in the third quarter by a John Bostic cheap shot.
You win this game, you're in first place in the division.
What more do you need? You just got embarrassed at Washington on October 25th. You look at the yards. You barely had any yards. The game ends with Ben DiNucci at quarterback, right? Okay. Is there anything more than revenge against your arch rival?
Yeah.
Okay.
So now, not only do I take I set you back, because now I've got 4 wins. I'm in first place. I got to set you back 1. So I'm sitting pretty. And I still got Philly, and I still get the Giants.
Mm-hmm.
So that's all the motivation I need. Skip, that's your arch rival. You can say the Giants and the Eagles and all that, Skip, but we know who it is. Because of the names alone. It goes.
So above and beyond your issues with the racist connotation.
Yes.
Why was Mike McCarthy gloating about this?
Yes!
I've been doing this for a long time, and I knew I had to come up with something.
You were
that's what you
seven.
Came. Think
two
about it. Let that sink in, Skip. That's what he came up with. Of all the time, he's sitting around. I got to get these guys motivated. Not a speech by Rockney. Not by some army general.
a motivational.
Yes.
Speaker, yeah.
We got to storm the beach like Normandy. Not that.
Show Rocky something.
Not that.
No.
Let me see. Let me get about 7 or 8 watermelons. Take them to Minnesota. Get a couple of hammers and ask the guys to smash them. And then I'm going to get the black guys. And they're like, oh, yeah, let me smash, let me. Boy, y'all. If I was in the barbershop, y'all know what I would be saying.
Mm-hmm. Well, I just hope Washington is enough to get my team ready to play on Thursday because the whole season teeters on this game.
What is,
here we go.
If somebody would have just said that, man, I wouldn't even believe it. I wouldn't believe it. If somebody would have told me an NFL team did that, I said, man, stop playing. Nobody do no foolishness like that.
No mercy.
The Lakers re-signed Markieff Morris yesterday, adding even more depth to LA's roster. Reports had Markieff deciding between staying with the Lakers or joining his twin brother Marcus on the Clippers. Morris shot 42% from three-point range during the playoffs and log minutes at the power forward spot in the Lakers' small ball lineup. So, Shannon, how significant is this?
Skip, this is a great deal. He gives them tremendous versatility. Remember the series against the Rockets? He ended up playing. He played a lot of minutes in that series. They ended up starting. But it just goes to show you he can shoot the three. Shot 42% from the three in the playoffs. That's very good. He can defend. He's a big body. Physical. And I like this, Skip. Think about this. We signed him for the minimum. They gave the twin brother $64 million, 16 a year. And my guy played better than your guy.
He did?
He did.
Huh?
Which one of the twins gonna go to? Which twin gonna be at the family reunion with jewelry on?
Huh?
Which one?
Well, he went along for a ride.
No, that's Skip. To see that you know the man didn't go along for no ride. You just told me he started against Houston. He played well. What about when he came in against the Heat?
He had his moments.
Okay then. What about where your guy moments at?
Is it my turn?
No, it's not your turn. Think about this. AD, Schroeder. Here's the line. This is our starting line. This is why we gonna start. Ron. AD, KCP, Schroeder.
Schroeder's going to start?
And Wesley Matthews.
Schroeder's not coming off the bench?
No,
your shock troops? What about your second
and
unit?
And then we're going to come with the Caruso.
I think Caruso's going to be a starter.
He ain't starting. Kuzma, Keith. Woo! We might start Gasol, though. We might have to start Gasol. We'll see how it plays out. But I like where we are. We got better. We are a better team. Let this sink in for just a second. We are a better team than the one that the purple and gold confetti rained down on in the bubble.
Really?
Yes, we better.
Could have fooled me.
No, you're going to be fooled again.
How are you going to get Gasol up and down the court? Are you going to put him on some kind of riser and just, like, cart him up and down?
He can run up and down. I tell you what he can do. He can keep up with Zubats. He can keep up with him.
Zub can run that court.
No, Zub can't do nothing.
Yeah, he can.
Well, he better learn how to play defense against Yoke. That's what he better do.
I think it's my turn. This was fine for you guys. I was happy for you guys.
I'm much happier
for the Clippers because the Clippers still have by far the better Morris twin.
No, they don't.
By far. And yet, here's the irony of this. Speaking of identical twins, just for those who haven't followed this closely, Markieff and Marcus. So for their careers, obviously having played the same amount of time since they're exactly the same age, but look at this. For their careers, Keith has averaged 11, 5, and 2 in 26 minutes a game, and Marcus has averaged 12, 5, and 2 in 27 minutes a game. So they almost have identical stats. It's impossibly.
Exactly, yes.
Great, you know, that these two have done that right in this league.
And remember, they started off together, Skip.
I know. Okay. So, now, where are they now? Well, Keith, he played a small but important role for the Lakers. I give you that. But he played 35 games for the Lakers, including the playoffs, and he started three times. Mm-hmm. Okay. Marcus is a key figure now with the Clippers because he played 32 games and started all 32. And I got to tell you, when it really mattered against, let's say, Luka in the first round of the playoffs, who was the primary defender on Luka? It was Marcus Morris.
And he cheap-shotted him.
He did.
But you know they went and got an enforcer. You see who they signed? Try that next year with James Johnson on the court.
Okay, but it happened. Primary defender because he's got real edge to him.
Yeah.
And he will get up into you.
Okay.
And he will do it by any means possible.
Yeah, he cheap-shotted me. You know it.
It's Markieff Morris. So he's become incredibly valued as a starter, which is why they gave him his money. He earned his money.
You had to, Skip, because you gave up a first-round pick to get him.
Okay.
We got Keith on a buyout and paid huge dividends. And he said, run it back.
Okay. So you just said Markieff shot 42% from three in the playoffs.
Yep.
Guess who shot 48% from three for the Clippers in the playoffs? The twin brother.
He ain't played but six games. He should have.
48%? Well, they played more than six.
Oh, they lost to seven, and then they beat what you got. So they played 13 games.
Okay.
How many games did my guy play?
Okay, check this out. So your guy took 69 threes in the playoffs and made 29 yep. for 69. My guy made 28 of only 59 shots and shot 48%. That's extraordinary. That went under radar. He didn't have a good playoffs. He had a great playoffs.
Did he?
Yes.
So where was he in games 5, 6, and 7?
He was out there.
Oh, he was
fighting. Yeah.
He was out there.
Yeah. I didn't think they featured him enough.
Hold on. Help me understand this now. So you mean to tell me a team that got Kawhi, PG, a playoff Paul, Marcus Morris, mm-hmm. they got sweet Lou Will.
Yep.
They had Jermichael Green. And they could. I know they weren't up 3-1.
No. Closer.
He shot 48% for the three.
It should have been Lou Williams, but Lou took a little side trip during the bubble, right?
It should have been Kawhi Leonard.
What did you call him? Lemon Pepper Lou,
First of all, Skip, hold on. Let this sink in for a second. We don't have... Can you imagine Steve Kerr being counted on the close for the Bulls? Can you imagine somebody coming off the bench?
That's a terrible analogy.
Hold on.
Why would you say that?
Kawhi
Williams has been multiple sixth man of the year.
That doesn't matter. Has he been finals MVP?
No, but he's been that team's closer for four years.
Hold on. You told me, when LeBron James passed the ball, you talk about why would he pass the ball to Kyle Korver? Mm-hmm. I say, well, Skip, he's shooting 60% from corner threes. He won the all-time great. But he's not playing finals MVP. He's never done that.
He'd never taken that shot before in that moment.
Okay, Sweet Lou never done it. What Kawhi's doing.
Well,
Kawhi's finals MVP.
But that team had never been in that spot.
Okay, so I want to know why when you got two superstars, you're asking the sixth man to come. I told you
from the start. I first guessed this. I said the closer for this team has to be Lou Williams.
Why not Kawhi?
Kawhi's never been a closer.
Why not Paul George? What about playoff P?
George Paul?
Yeah, what
seriously?
About, yeah.
Never been a closer. He's the last guy with the ball in his hands with the game on the line, especially
in
the second round.
You traded five first-round draft picks starting in 2022, yep. 3, 4, 5, 6 for a guy that can't close?
Can't close. Yet, that team just in firepower and star power, Las Vegas said that's the best team in basketball, and they are the favorite going into last year's playoffs. Okay, the Clippers.
Skip. Once January 1st, 2021 hit, I don't want to hear nothing about it mentioned 2020 again, ever in life.
Lou Williams never wanted to be in the bubble.
What is Vegas saying right now about this year? Who's the favorite right now?
Well, let's see. It's probably going to fluctuate.
Ain't nothing fluctuating.
Yep.
Ain't nothing fluctuating.
Skip. I like what the Clippers did. They had a little better free agent period than the Lakers.
You like what y'all did. Yep. I love what the Lakers done.
So we kept starter Marcus, and you got sub Keith. Well, good for you. Congratulations.
You see?
It's good. Way to go.
As long as you know your role.
Yeah.
See, if I'm an extra on a big movie with Denzel, ain't no sense in me trying to read his lines. That's not what they got me in there for.
Mm.
Keith knows his role. You see what happened when Marcus first got there, he thought he was still at the Knicks, and he was just shooting, and y'all were losing.
Mm.
The greatest part of any team is knowing your role, knowing your place. Where do I fit in?
Mm. Yep.
My grandma said, "Hey, grown folks, and everybody knows it. Boy, stay in your place. Grown folks talking. You don't talk. Keith understands his role.
Mm.
He comes in, plays his 25, 26 minutes. He gets you his rebounds. He hits open shots. He plays hard. That's his role. Nothing more, nothing less.
So you kept Keith, and you lost Rondo, and you lost Dwight, and you lost JaVale, and you lost Danny Green, and you lost Avery Bradley, and you're over there crowing about what a great free agent period you had?
Love it. Love it.
Wow.
Because guess what? Because when you said all that, what did we keep? Skip, the thing about what did we keep? It's always, he gave $5 billion to this endowment.
Mm.
How much does he have?
Mm. Well, your best player is still a free agent.
No, but my guy's a free agent. My guy, we trying to see what the tea leaves shake out. Are we going to do a 1-1? Because we're a magician. We got something up our sleeve. You know Gold James got something up his sleeve, right?
Is it possible AD's going to wind up elsewhere? Is it possible he's had enough of LeBron? I don't know.
How you get enough of winning titles?
Mm.
Kawhi, Kyrie had enough.
Mm.
and ain't been past the second round since.
Well, he won.
He had enough.
He won one for LeBron.
No, he didn't.
And then he...
Well, this is what I don't understand. How can you do something for someone else that you can't do for yourself? Who does that? I mean, I give my brother a kidney, but not if I only have one. Hey, you win LeBron a ring, but can't win yourself one?
Well, LeBron needs a closer, and he got one.
Who the closer now?
80? Now?
Yeah, 80 to go.
Well, they didn't need one in the bubble.
Oh, there you go. See, at some point, time skip.
Do you realize they avoided in the bubble the teams with the top five records? They didn't have to.
So, what you mean they avoided them?
Wow.
So, were they not?
How lucky was that?
Hold on. Did they not come down? Were they not invited? Skip, I gave you RSVP.
Nobody was into it.
Skip, I sent you an invite.
Yeah.
I said RSVP. You came. And we sent you away.
You lucked into the pandemic championship, and it's great. Way to go. Congratulations. Enjoy it while it lasts.
We're going to get another one.
But now the real season's going to start.
So let me ask you a question. When we win the title this year, what would be your argument to try to diminish or minimize what Goat James has done?
Well, the only argument would be if they have to go back into a bubble again for the playoffs, which remains a possibility.
So let me ask you a question. So whoever wins the Super Bowl, is it going to be an asterisk by it?
Well, you can't have a bubble in pro football, so no, it's not quite the same.
Hold on. But you just told me the Raiders played, they had four starters out with COVID.
Mm-hmm.
The 49ers had their whole team out and lost. Key players are being, Myles Garrett is out again.
He is.
The Ravens got two of their starting running backs are out.
Yep.
So if they're going to be an asterisk by it, if guys are missing time, key guys?
I don't know. Do you want to put one by?
No, I didn't put one by that one. I put one by that one.
But you know and I know.
No, I know. We the champs. I know. That's what I know. And I know.
Yeah.
You see this, Skip?
So.
About to be half five.
Congrats.
We about to have five rings. I got five on it.
Congrats. You got Keith.
Yes.
I got Marcus.
Yes. Yeah, we got Keith.
I'm happy. From the team, Shannon?
It's coming.
It's on its way. Probably, right? Okay, good.
I'm going to be there on the 22nd.
You know what? Even I got one of those rings. It's cubic zirconia. No. I went out and bought one.
I'm going to be at the 22nd. I bet y'all be in state.
No mercy.
The Rams beat the Buccaneers last night 27-24 despite rushing for less than 2 yards per carry. Jared Goff picked apart the Tampa secondary for 376 yards and 3 touchdowns, including over 100 yards to both Robert Woods and Cooper Kupp. Meanwhile, Tom Brady finished with 216 passing yards and a season low 4.5 yards per attempt, and also threw 2 interceptions, including one on the Bucs' final drive when they had a chance to tie or take the lead. The game gave the 43-year-old Brady his third loss in primetime this season. We're now joined by the Rambassador himself, Fox Sports NFL analyst Eric Dickerson. Eric, it is so good to see you, and I see that smile on your face. What was your biggest takeaway from last night?
Well, the biggest takeaway I got to start with first is how ugly those uniforms are on television. You know, those uniforms are horrible. But, you know, we won the football game. I think the big thing is that you saw Batman without Robin last night. And that's Tom Brady without Bill Belichick. It really shows that offense does not fit him. It really doesn't. Pushing the ball downfield, that's not him. I think that I'd say this is one of the first times I've ever seen Tom Brady really, really uncomfortable in a situation. You know, normally if he throws an interception, you'll see him yell at the receiver and, you know, talk to the receiver like you need to be here, you need to be there. But you didn't see that last night because I think Tom Brady's a little unsure also of where the ball is supposed to go at times. You saw a guy that I think when you go back to when we played them in the Super Bowl, 2 years ago, our offense was better then than it is now. And here's a team that, you know, we did what we wanted to do with them. I mean, and when I think about that Super Bowl, Bill Belichick shut down one of the high-powered offenses in the National Football League that year, held us to 3 points. And here we are with Tom Brady with the Buccaneers. You know, they can't almost, I want to say get out their own way, but they have great players, especially receivers, but they're not getting the best out of their receivers. You see Tom Brady looking for Julian Edelman. He's not there. You see him looking for a young Rob Gronkowski. He's there, but he's not there. You see him looking for James White, you know, to catch the ball out of the backfield. You know, he's not there. So for me, I say you see Batman without Robin right now, and that's Tom Brady without Bill Belichick. And, you know, I think they really go hand in hand.
Skip, when we discussed it, when they actually did the follow-up on Edie's 1 point about the Super Bowl, the biggest difference is no Cooper Kupp. Remember, he tore his ACL. You see the difference that Cooper Kupp makes in a ball game like this? They had no answer. He ran the option route on the guy. The guy's like, he did that to me? But when you look at this, ED, I watched last night. They did something really, really with Brady. Is that Brady was hard play action or everything with the quick. And I just tweeted, I said, at some point in time, you got to press somebody. Because Brady will prick you apart. If you just let the receivers go down there and turn around, Brady's just, he's too accurate. Well, Williams started pressing AB. Jalen Ramsey started pressing Mike Evans. And it says, we don't believe Godwin can beat us. So now let's go play football. And just that little bit of timing was enough to throw Tom Brady out. Tom was terrible last night. 0-for-6 with 2 interceptions on throws of 20 yards down the field. Last 4 games, he's 1-for-20 on throws 20 yards down the field with 3 interceptions. Skip, your guy. And ED, I don't know, did you see this? Let me show, I got a blooper reel I want to show you. Can you throw the ball forward twice, ED? Can you throw it forward, get it batted back, catch it, and throw it forward again? What is this, Skip?
I thought that was his best pass of the night.
Hold on. He must be thought he was Colorado, Missouri. You got a 5th down. Skip, what is this?
He completed that ball.
Skip, what is that?
That was goatish.
Skip, that's year 21. That's like a rookie quarterback lining up on the guard to take the snap. Skip, you can't do that. That's your goat. Is that your goat?
Yeah, that's why I said that was goatish. That was something. I've never seen a quarterback pull that off before.
Lowercase goat.
Get a pass slapped right back in his face, and he completes the ball?
You ever seen that? And let that sink in.
Thank you for showing that.
And had they not declined it, that's the only reason he got 216. He'd have been under 210 yards passing if it had not been for an illegal pass. Skip, can we just say, I'm going to turn it over to you. Mm-hmm. Can we just say Tom Brady wasn't good last night, Skip? Mm. It's not to diminish what he's already accomplished. We're talking about last night.
Tom Brady was outstanding in the first half of that football game. He was dealing.
He was on fire.
So back to Eric's first point. This was actually Batman without pass protection or a running game or even a semblance of a defense that could defend the pass. You're like naked out there. You're like, what am I supposed to do? Because without Ali Marpet, his best offensive lineman, and for the 3rd straight game, we talked about it yesterday, he's out in concussion protocol. So now they got the backup center playing, and they had to move the center to guard. And then in that last series, remember, the backup center got hurt. They're up against an Eric Dickerson Los Angeles Rams defense that just might be the best defense in pro football. They have allowed the least yards in pro football. I told Shannon yesterday, I predicted this. I first guessed it, Eric. I said that Tom Brady is up against it tonight. This is an awful matchup for him because obviously your guys can get there with 4. And in the 3rd quarter, they started bringing the heat on him in ways that Todd Bowles could never bring the heat on Jared Goff. He's Jared Cough It Up. And they never touched him. They didn't hit him. They didn't sack him. They let him get incredibly comfortable. Do you realize that the Tampa defense, which is not a playoff defense, do you realize it let Jared Goff come within 1 completion of the all-time Monday night completion record? Do you understand? That's 39 completions. 40 is the all-time Monday night record. What's it go back to? 1970 Monday Night Football? So think about that. In the last 2 games at Tampa, what I call Tampa Bay, in primetime on a Sunday night and a Monday night, Drew Brees and Jared Goff combined to complete almost 80% of their passes. Well, you're up against it. So you're up against 2 really good defenses, obviously New Orleans and Los Angeles. And Tom Brady's just trying to do the best he can. I thought under the circumstances, I told you yesterday, this got to be a Ronald Jones game. Guess what? The Tampa Bay Buccaneers ran it 18 times last night and averaged 2.3 yards per rush.
Skip, that's your best. Hold on.
Okay, you got no chance.
That's your house, though.
Okay.
That's your house. They came and do your, I mean, how you going to let somebody come eat up all your food and don't make good, have no repercussions?
Okay, so I'm telling you, Brady actually went 7 of 14 on 3rd down, which is pretty great. He actually went 3 of 3 in the red zone, which is pretty great. he actually put up great numbers in the first half. He had one drive that was just sensational, and you say he's playing terrible?
Skip. At one point, he had 129 yards.
Yeah, but he had 45 yards in the first half on pass interference penalties. Those don't count in the yardage.
No, they don't.
Well, wait. I got to show my man Eric one tape here, because this is to go ahead 14-7. If we could see what happened mid-second quarter, can we see these throws by Tom Brady? That's 3rd and 6 to Cameron Brate. The next one's 3rd and 9 to Cameron Brate. This is just a rocket to the boundary. Thank you. And then how about another 3rd and 8? Tell me this isn't a fastball. That's the little Scotty Miller, and it's pass interference on your man Fuller, the rookie. And then here we go to finish off the drive to Mike Evans on Jalen Ramsey to get it down to the 2-yard line. Thank you. And you tell me that's terrible? Are you kidding me?
Yep.
And Skip, but that was in the first half, wasn't it?
Yeah.
We got a second half also.
Yeah, right back.
I give you this.
My job in the first half, I'm done. You know, it doesn't work like that.
In the third quarter, your guys tore Tom Brady apart. He took some serious Drew Brees-style punishment in the third quarter. And I'm the first to admit, he got a little happy-footed in the fourth quarter, because you do. I mean, you have that guy named Aaron Donald? Don't I always hear about how he's the best player in pro football?
He is great. And the thing is, he makes everybody around him great. One thing, when you look at our defense, I got to say that Jalen Ramsey, when I look at those pass interferences, you know, both guys are pushing. You know, it's always, and I'm an offensive player, but sometimes you have to say, look, come on, man. Both of them are pushing.
Yeah, play through it.
You just can't call it. You got to let them play football. But Jalen Ramsey, you know, Shannon, you know, you call a guy got some dog in him.
Mm-hmm.
He has dog in him.
He does.
Makes our defensive secondary that much better.
Yep.
I mean, he really does. Then you got Aaron Donald up front. You know, you got Floyd. I mean, all the guys are playing very, very good football, aggressive football. And what they did to Tom Brady, I told you this last week. I said, no quarterback. I don't care. It's Tom Brady, whoever. It goes Joe Montana. it doesn't make a difference. Russell Wilson. None of them like to be hit.
Mm-mm.
You hit them enough. You put enough pressure on them. You get in their face enough.
Hey, Eric.
After a while, you rattle them.
Jared Goff does not like to get hit. And if you beat him up early, what did he do at Miami? He turned it over 4 times in the first half. They never touched him last night. Todd Bowles with his creative blitzes. Nobody got home.
But, Ed, help me understand this, Ed. Now, you and I, we've been trying to talk about Coach Belichick and the influence that he had on Tom Brady. But when it comes to those Super Bowls, Skip Bayless don't want to mention anything about his defense. Now he says Tampa doesn't have any defense because Tom Brady looked bad last night. He talked about, the offensive line. You never see, the problem that I have with people when they critique Tom, they never give people credit. When they win, it's only Tom. But when they lose, it was the defense fault. The offensive line didn't block.
Okay.
The running back can't run.
Well, don't do that. Give me an answer for this one. What did Tom do maybe best in his years at New England? He'd find the safety valve. He'd flip it to little James White and get 20 yards.
Yes.
Last night, he flipped it 4 times to Leonard Fournette, and he dropped 3 of them right in his hands.
Skip.
Well, you're out. You got no shot.
ED.
What's left?
ED. They did not. The Rams did not take ED. Well, I think he was the second pick in the draft. He was the second pick in the draft, ED. They didn't draft ED to throw him swing passes. They drafted ED to hand him the ball. Leonard Fournette got drafted to run the football. He's not a pass catcher. He can catch, but he's not James White out of the backfield.
Hey, he tiptoes to the line of scrimmage like nobody I've ever seen.
That's a different argument.
Tiptoes.
That's a different argument, ED.
I mean, come on. Hey,
you know. When I got to say that, really, when I think about it, I go to the Super Bowl when we played the Patriots. I got to say, Bill Belichick, he outcoached Sean McVay. He really did. And last night, Sean McVay outcoached Bruce Arians last night. You saw it. You know, look, neither one of us could run the football. But you know how running the football, those little dump down passes,
yes.
those little passes they threw.
Jailbreak screens.
Those little quick screens. You know, that's how you run with the Robert Woods, the Cooper Kupp. You hit them short and let them take up a long run. Sometimes you just can't run the football out of the backfield. We tried to run a tight end sweep. It did. You know, we picked up about 4 or 5 yards. You know, both teams on running the football, you weren't going to run on either one of those teams last night. So you had to come up with creative ways. And one thing about Bruce Arians is when it comes to his offense, he's real stubborn about it. He said, we're still going to push the ball downfield. We're still going to push the ball. Great. That's going to give our defense time to get to Tom Brady.
Yeah.
Okay. So I'll be the first to admit publicly that Tom Brady made one horrible throw.
Several.
And it ended the game. And the problem was he starts off hot in the drive. He hit Cameron Brate, and then he hits Godwin for 12 more yards. And here we go. And he loves Cameron Brake because he trusts him in big moments. And he gets a step on the other safety right up the seam. And Brady thinks, I can force this in there. And he tries to force it, and he just airmails Cameron Brate and throws it right to Fuller, who looked like the primary receiver on the target on the play.
Skip, he did not throw the ball. The one that almost got picked on the right rail by Mike Evans, he should have worked the other side to A.B. A.B. had single high. The safety had cheated towards Mike Evans. Skip, he didn't play well.
Okay.
It's okay.
You are criticizing the GOAT.
Yes!
Who won six rings with six game-winning drives in the fourth quarter overtime.
But see, that's the thing. But Skip, that's the thing. Just because you've had success doesn't mean you're above reproach or being critiqued about your play. He didn't play well last night. He missed some reads. That's okay. He's human.
Just like LeBron, he didn't have enough help.
No, Skip. Yep. I just want to know, why is it an awful matchup for the GOAT? If you the GOAT, ain't no awful matchups.
Well, the GOAT's in a whole new ballpark, right? You've got all new teammates and all new coaches.
You could take a GOAT from the South and bring him to California. He's going to stand on a bus.
Yeah.
He'll go eat grass. He's still a GOAT, right, E.D.? E.D., guess what? They took E.D. out of L.A. and put him in Indy. And guess what he did? Win the Russian title, because that's what he does.
Okay.
Preach, Shannon.
You keep it up. Oh, he the GOAT. He the GOAT. I don't want to hear that. I don't want to hear no excuses.
All right, Eric. We
Ambassador, congratulations.
Yes.
Congratulations.
Congrats.
Way to go.
No mercy.
Montrezl Harrell spoke with the media yesterday for his first time since leaving the Clippers for the Lakers. The reigning sixth man of the year said joining the Lakers was a, quote, business decision. And when he was asked if the Clippers wanted him back, he replied, obviously, it doesn't seem that way, does it? Fox Sports NBA analyst Chris Broussard joins us now. So, Chris, what does this tell you?
It tells me that Montrez is right on the money. I've talked to somebody close to this situation, and I'm told the Clippers did not want Montrez back. They felt like his personality wasn't a good fit for that locker room. Rightly or right or wrong, they felt, you know, it was something, he was obnoxious. And it just was a big contributor to their locker room and chemistry problems last year. So it also was magnified because that team, and still, this still is a problem, they don't have a leader. As great as Kawhi Leonard is, he is not a leader. As great as Paul George is, not a leader. And Patrick Beverley's kind of silly and loud and all that, but not a leader. Lou comes off the bench, not a leader. So there was nobody in that locker room to kind of get Montrez to chill out or, you know, whatever, fix it. And so it was a problem. So especially with them being able to sign Serge Ibaka, the Clippers actually feel this was addition by subtraction. So Montrez is right on the money with that. Now, I think he won't be a problem whatsoever in the Lakers locker room because they do have leadership. And he has great respect for LeBron. Obviously, LeBron is a great leader. So I don't foresee this being any problem for the Lakers that it was for the Clippers. As far as which team kind of had the best free agency, look, early on, the Lakers were just smacking the Clippers around. I mean, it was a rout. But with getting Serge Ibaka, man, I love this move. I can't scream enough about how good this is for the Clippers. He gives them a seven-footer. We know they needed size, especially against Denver and the Lakers. And he could protect the rim, but also step out, hit the three-pointer. He's a great locker room guy. He's smart on the court, so that improves their basketball IQ, which is what Kawhi wanted. And also, Luke Kennard wasn't a bad addition. If he could stay healthy, he's a really good player if he can be healthy. All that said, it's the Lakers.
Thank you.
I mean, the Lakers.
Late show.
Going into last season, it was, we know they got the best duo. But do they have enough of a supporting cast? Enough of a bench? Now, they still probably have the best duo, you know, assuming LeBron doesn't fall off more than a fraction at age 36. And they've got a great supporting cast. They got the two best six men last year in Montrez and Schroeder, Dennis Schroeder. And then Wes Matthews gives them the 3-and-D that Danny Green or Avery Bradley, you lose with them. Mark Gasol is a smart defender, stretches the floor, can shoot the three. A little bit of rim protection, even though he's not a leaper athletic. Only thing they lost was athleticism at the rim with Dwight Howard and JaVale McGee. Outside of that, they're better. They are the runaway favorites in the whole NBA.
Serge Ibaka was a great defensive player. But you know, Chris, Serge Ibaka hadn't been All-NBA defensive since 2014. And last year, would you believe this? Mark Gasol averaged more blocks than Serge Ibaka? The great rim protector, Serge Ibaka. Mm-hmm. Mark Gasol averaged more blocks.
Well, Gasol started. He got to play more minutes. We'll see how that works out now.
And Mark Gasol can pass. He's a very good passing big man.
So can Serge.
Pass, pick, and roll. Now we can pick and pop. We weren't going to be able to do that. We could just pick and roll to the rim with Dwight and JaVale McGee. Now we can pick and pop. Can you imagine how many lobs Trez going to get now? But the one thing the Clippers didn't improve, Chris, you came on here last week saying it would be a slam dunk if they got Rondo. Who is going to run the point? Nobody.
Who is going to back up LeBron?
And they know it.
Yep. Where is playoff Rondo for the Lakers?
We got
who
Schroeder.
Is he?
We got Schroeder and Caruso.
Schroeder. Playoff Schroeder. Good luck.
We got Rondo paid. Yeah. Remember now, nobody wanted Rondo. The Lakers picked up Rondo for $2.5 million, right, Chris?
Time out. I think it's my turn.
It's your turn.
Chris, I'm having the best time sitting over here listening to my man Shannon Sharp try to duck and dodge the truth that you just spoke, Chris Broussard just spoke. Which is that after you gloated all day yesterday, we got Trez.
We stole
Trez from the Clippers. He didn't want to be a Clipper. He wanted to be a Laker. Time out. Sorry, the Clippers did not want him. He was a bad fit in many ways, shapes, and forms because he was a bad fit defensively. When they were in the bubble in the playoffs, he was a liability on defense against Denver. I'm sorry, now you get the liability. So good luck with your second unit liability.
Watch him.
Okay?
Watch him this year. No bubble.
He's like 6'6", maybe.
Don't worry about it. He played like 7 foot.
You are going to so miss Dwight and JaVale, as Chris just pointed out, because you don't have that athleticism at the rim anymore. You don't have that kind of rim protection. Anthony can't give you that kind of rim protection.
Oh, he can. Don't you worry about Skip. Why are you worried about what AD got? AD is a champion. He's going to be a different animal.
Listen, Montrezl Harrell became, as Chris pointed out, a big problem in the locker room, a big problem for Kawhi Leonard and especially for Paul George. According to our man Chris Haynes, they clashed during and after game 2 of the Denver series, and Montrezl is all over him saying, "You're never wrong. You never admit you're wrong."
You're right.
Yeah, okay. Well, we'll see how that works. We'll see how LeBron likes having that big personality in his locker room, because when things start to slip south a little bit, you better be ready.
When have you heard that in the locker room with LeBron James? Everybody that have problems, they said that about Rondo. Was Rondo a problem? They said that about Dwight. Was that a problem? All that stuff that JaVale normally would do, taking threes and dribbling the ball, jumping up in the stands, was that a problem?
It wasn't, because you got the break of your life. You went to a bubble that nobody else wanted to be in except you guys. So congratulations for your pandemic championship.
You know what this is? The Trez Harrell signing reminds me of?
Yep.
Tom Brady signing with Tampa. He went to Tampa because New England didn't want him back. Doesn't matter how you get there, Chris.
You just compared Montrezl Harrell to Tom Brady.
You see what I said? Now
you're really reaching.
Chris, you heard what I said. I said the signing.
I like the Schroeder and Gasol, and I like Montrezl, but Schroeder and Gasol, I think, they're better signings than Montrezl.
Okay, do you think Schroeder's better than Rondo?
Again, he was a problem there.
Schroeder or Rondo? Who you got?
The only question, he's definitely better during the regular season. I think you'll even admit that. The only question is, we know playoff Rondo is special. But let's be honest, playoff Rondo, as great as he was, part of that is because the expectations are low. Now, nobody's expecting Rondo to be what he was, you know, in Boston. You know, so when he comes in and plays well, it's like, oh, wow, Rondo was great. And he was. It's just like Dwight, though. Dwight, everybody raved about how well he played last year. Why? because nothing was expected.
Right.
He was a shadow of what he used to be when he was a star, but because nothing was expected, it was like, hey, Dwight was really good. So I think Schroeder is definitely a better player than Rondo at this point. And even if he doesn't take it to another level like Rondo does in the playoffs, I think Schroeder will be better for them in the playoffs than Rondo was.
Because you have to also understand, you look at Rondo, you look at normally when he went places like the Pelicans, he had AD. He goes to Sacramento, he had Boogie. But you look at him in Dallas, how did that work out, Skip? So how is it going to look like? What is it going to look like in Atlanta? Who the big in Atlanta? Oh, Clint Capella. Oh, Clint Capella going to give you 20 and 20, huh? Or maybe John Collins. I love Rondo. We would love to have had him back. But you can't turn down the opportunity because, like I said, $15 million guaranteed, Skip. Mm. But I like where we are. But don't think we don't. We got a little something else, too, brewing.
Yeah.
We got something else brewing, Chris. Mm. We got something else brewing.
Well, is it going to be called cap circumvention? Because you got no cap money left.
Why you
but you know what? If it's a clutch client, clutch clients don't count against the Laker cap. That's a new rule.
Bird rights.
It's the LeBron rule.
Bird rights.
LeBron rights, right? Clutch client, nope, doesn't count against
the cap. I want to know why.
Building the juggernaut. We got to give him that.
Got something for you. Mm. Kawhi. I want to see what the commercial is. What commercial you think they're going to shoot this year? When he took his little shot, the little king, the crown? Mm. You ain't mentioned that, Skip.
Mm.
Are the billboards still up?
Yep.
Are the billboards still up? Kawhi time.
It's your time to gloat. You got your cubic zirconia championship ring, and I'm happy for you. You got a huge break. You guys are both, you're underestimating how much you lost in Rondo and Dwight and Danny Green and JaVale and Avery Bradley, all tough defensively. You fell so far defensively that it'll start to show itself early next year. Just wait.
Wes Matthews can play defense. Did you see Braun? Did you see Braun play defense?
Yeah,
you remember
can.
When LeBron sat in the chair on Kawhi and Paul George on the final possession?
Mm.
You remember that? When he said, they called him, they're like, well, who you want? Hey, go, who you want? Mm. I want him. He refused to address him by name.
Mm.
I want him.
Mm.
And locked him down.
All I know is that Serge Ibaka was the number one premier signing of the whole free agent period, and the Clippers got him.
He was. Chris.
No, he was.
This man.
Skip, you know I was with you this year on the Clippers, but that ship has sailed.
Oh.
Right now, it's the Lakers.
Lego, baby.
No mercy.
How about this? Start your Thanksgiving with Undisputed. We'll be coming to you live Thursday morning to preview the Cowboys' potential first-place showdown against Washington later that day on Fox at 4 p.m. Eastern, plus a look at the two other Turkey Day matchups and all the latest on a wild time in NBA free agency. That'll be at our regular time, 9:30 a.m. Eastern on Thanksgiving morning, only on FS1 and the Fox Sports app. So we will be with you for the holiday, and we hope you tuned in as usual. This one last night, after losing to the Rams, Tom Brady walked off the field without shaking hands with Jared Goff. Brady took some heat earlier this season for not shaking hands with Nick Foles after the Bears upset the Bucs, and now social media is starting to wonder if Brady could have better sportsmanship. Shannon, I saw you tweeting about this. Do you have a problem with everything here?
I do, because it seems to me, Skip, that you know, he did it to Nick Foles. Well, I don't have a relationship. I don't know him that well. And it seems to me that when he wins, he knows him. But what's at this, Skip? He does it. He feels Jared Goff. He feels Nick Foles are beneath him. I can't shake your hand. You beat me. Drew Brees beat him. He shook his hand. No problem. Sprint it to the middle of the field. Peyton Manning is beating him. Because he feels, okay, well, I'm on a level playing field. Mm. But he feels these other guys are beneath him. He needs to, this is ridiculous. Now, I went through the archives. I pulled something. The guy that he's probably going to say he doesn't know, take a look at this photo, people at home. Look at this photo. This is the Super Bowl. The guy that beat him last night that he's going to claim he doesn't know, look what he's doing.
He didn't claim he didn't know him.
He said he didn't know Nick Foles because he won the game. Mm. It's funny. Mm. It's funny. Why can somehow he always find a way to shake hands when he wins? Mm. He always finds a way. If Tom Brady wins, it ain't got nothing to do about no COVID. Because I don't want to hear nothing about no COVID because you went to the middle of the field and you shook hands with Aaron Rodgers. Mm. You went to the middle of the field and you shook hands with Drew Brees. So COVID is off the table.
Mm.
off the table. And you're supposed to have a mask on the sideline. The NFL says we want all players when you're not in the game to have a mask on. So I don't want to hear nothing about no COVID. Skip Bayless, this is ridiculous. He needs to hold himself accountable. You remember in Chicago, guys making mistakes, he yelling and screaming. Who yelling at Tom Brady for playing like he played last night, Skip? It's a one-way street. It can't be
Did
like
he
that.
Did he yell at anybody last night?
No, he should. They should have been yelling at him. That's my point. Thank you. You make my point for me. Because he played like hot garbage. Hot, a mess.
Really? They lost 27 to 24.
It doesn't matter.
They had a chance to win.
They didn't have no chance to win. They had zero chance to win.
What if I tried to explain to you many times on this show about the GOAT, the unquestioned GOAT, not the phony GOAT like your guy LeBron James?
No, your guy phony GOAT.
Really?
Yeah.
Tom Brady's the phony GOAT with six championships and nine
tries?
Last
night, he was the lowercase GOAT. Oh. Jared Goff was, Big G. Big G was the GOAT last night.
I have tried to explain to you, and this is what I love about Tom Brady, he is the sorest loser on the planet. He is a lousy loser. Reminds me a little bit of a story you used to tell about you and your brother playing basketball.
That was different. I was a kid.
You were a kid, but you're playing basketball, and your big brother, Sterling, would just take you to school.
Yep.
And you would just take the basketball and throw it out in the woods.
I would.
Right?
Yes. Okay. And that's, my grandma say, take your you-know-what and get that ball.
That is a sore loser. That's the GOAT. That's
Skip,
Tom Brady.
Skip, that's different.
The oldest cliche in sports is, show me a good loser, and I will show you a loser.
Hold on. What about role models? So now I don't want to hear you say anything else about LeBron.
Care.
Hold, no.
He doesn't care.
I don't want to hear you say anything else about the language LeBron uses. Because you say, LeBron, you're a role model. You can't speak like that. Well, I don't want to hear it.
That's away from sports. He just gratuitously throws in the F word and tweets and...
What kind of sportsmanship? They watching. That wholesome image.
Does Tom Brady have an I Promise school in Akron or back in San Mateo? No, he doesn't.
Well, you can't have no kids. You can't have no school when you're acting like that, that kind of behavior.
Well,
that
behavior. True.
Skip.
He's the GOAT.
No, Skip.
He had just thrown a game-ending interception, and he was steamed.
Skip.
The last thing he wants to do is go to the middle of the field and shake somebody's hand. He's not going to do it.
Think about
this. You can have sportsmanship, poor sportsmanship.
Think about this.
You can have it.
Think about this. Russell Wilson threw the interception that cost the Super Bowl.
He's a great
guy. He trotted to the field.
He's a better guy. Better guy than Tom Brady. I will give you that. He's not a better quarterback. He's a better guy.
I know who is a better quarterback.
Yep.
But that's not what we're talking about, Skip Bayless. Skip,
and I'm glad you brought up COVID because I'm going to put it back on the table. There was one reason for Tom not to trot to the middle of the field. If we could show Jared Goff again, he's out there without a mask. Face to face with everybody, that's outrageously wrong. I'm sorry.
I thought
we'd arrived at a point in understanding COVID. It's out of control. The pandemic numbers are the worst.
Well, Tom Brady ain't got no mask on.
Okay, well, he went straight to the locker room. He's gone. He is out. He's not fraternizing.
Hold on. He's 1-3.
Look at all these players.
Yeah.
How dangerous is that? Thank you for wearing a mask.
Skip, don't do that.
Yep.
Don't do it.
Seriously.
Yes.
Every other story I click on is somebody's tested positive in college or pro football.
Yes.
And it's rampant.
And the NFL is saying, moving forward.
You just have to wear masks.
We want guys on the sideline. Who have their back.
But obviously filters into fraternizing at the end of the game.
It's supposed to be that way.
It's supposed to be.
But the fact of the matter is Tom Brady was not thinking about no COVID.
Okay, but I'm just saying that was one reason not to go out there.
But Skip, that wasn't Skip.
In fact, if I were the commissioner, I would rule against having any fraternizing at the end of the game.
What did rule against football then?
Well, that's not, it didn't have to be part of the game.
Well, Skip.
Just go to your locker
room. Skip, you face to face with a guy, you tackling a guy.
Okay, but why would you go out there and talk? You're not talking on the field.
You don't think that. So
well, they talk. Some of them are just like fraternizing face to face, like nose to nose.
The offensive lineman and defensive lineman are nose to nose.
Okay, I got it, but why would you tempt fate anymore?
Hey, there's no tempting, no fate. We're not going to see, I know what you're trying to do. You're trying to distract.
No,
we're talking
I'm
about
not trying
Tom
to distract.
Brady's behavior.
Yep.
Tom Brady's behavior.
I owned it, and I hope he owns it. He should just own it. Nope. I was mad, and I went to the locker room. I'm good with
it's
that.
It's more to come.
Yep.
It's more to come. Skip, that's ridiculous. Come on, Skip. So this is the problem that I hate about you, is that you think Tom Brady is the only guy that hates to lose. You think Tom Brady is the only guy that spends hours and hours on his body, hours and hours on nutrition, and go out there and lay it all on the line and lose. It's like, man, I can't believe. It happens. But everybody that loses to him somehow finds the courage and the right approach. Hey, man, congratulations, good game. But him,
you know
and
what?
Y'all give him a pass.
I'm going to say the same thing to you said about running up the score. Stop it. Just go beat him. Go beat him.
They did.
Him in the locker room.
Jared Goff beat his butt.
Beat him again.
No.
You're still predicting they're going to be in the playoffs, so yeah. I guess you're going to say that Tom Brady's going to win some more games.
All I'm saying.
And when he wins, he will walk right out to the middle of the field. I hope he's masked and say, here.
This is what I know. Tom Brady is full of what the elephant left on the show ground. Mm. You know that. I know that. And people make excuses. Mm. But at some point in time, I don't care about
you. Nobody's making excuses. I'm making none.
Skip, I understand he's been to 9 Super Bowl. He's won 6.
Time out. Am I making any excuse for his behavior last night? I'm not. I just accept what it is.
No. You can't accept. See, that's the problem. If you accept it, you're saying you're okay with it.
I am. That's who he is. That's who he always was.
It's two things. You either coach it or you tolerate it. This is unacceptable.
Remember, that's the guy who won 6 rings with 6 game-winning drives in the fourth quarter of overtime. That's who he is. That's how he's built. Sorry. Mm-hmm. No role model. Mm-hmm. LeBron can be a role model. He can have I Promise.
We got it.
Yep.
I just believe. So hold on. So why is Michael Jordan still so upset at Isaiah about not shaking his hand? If it ain't no problem, and you co-signed it. So why is everybody so upset about that?
No, I didn't co-sign it. Oh,
yes, you
did.
Oh, you're doing that's the Michael Jordan. That's the Michael Jordan I know. No. Hold a grudge. So what? I just want to know.
I know, but he needs to hold grudges. He makes up grudges.
I'm just trying to figure if so nobody should have a problem that Isaiah did. So why is everybody still so upset at Isaiah? Why was everybody trying to keep him out of the Olympics? If you're okay with Tom Brady, so why are we okay with one and not the other?
Well, what are you talking about? Isaiah?
And yes.
Okay, well, he froze out Jordan in the All-Star game? Is that what you want to get into?
This is about him not shaking the hand.
Okay. Well, they won some series, obviously, and finally he broke through and crushed them and swept them, and they just said, we're out.
Okay.
As a whole team.
And Jared Goff, so when you beat Jared Goff in the Super Bowl, mm-hmm. Jared Goff came to the... Imagine, you scored 3 points. You're the highest scoring offense.
Jared Goff was lucky to be there.
And then he beat the brakes off your guy. Mm. Your guy was you know what? He should have.
He beat the brakes off 27-24.
First of all, I'm upset that Tom Brady had his helmet off because we could recognize him. Mm. He should have put on somebody else's helmet and tucked his head so we couldn't see after that awful performance. Mm. You ought to be ashamed of yourself. He should have been even more ashamed.
Mm, I'm proud of him.
Okay, we're going to leave it for now. I don't know if we're going to agree on this one.
No mercy.
Well, the Bucs have been busy this offseason making moves in hopes that Giannis will sign his 5-year Supermax extension with the team. Anthony Davis has been waiting to sign his looming new deal with the Lakers, and those two delays may be connected. Brian Windhorst reported that if Giannis chooses to forego his extension and become a free agent next year, AD could sign a 1-year deal himself to give the Lakers salary flexibility to lure the back-to-back MVP to join up with Davis and LeBron in L.A. Huh. Chris Broussard is back with us. So, Chris, could you see this happening?
Well, I certainly think it's on the Lakers' radar. And when you look at some of the things LeBron's been able to accomplish in putting together rosters, it's a possibility. I mean, you'd be foolish to say there's no way it could happen. That said, I don't see it happening. I don't think Giannis will be drawn to Hollywood and L.A. I think his move will be a basketball move. And I think that is not like, if I'm Giannis and I don't stay in Milwaukee, I think there are better basketball options for him. I think in L.A., it's a possibility it could work, but he could become the third guy there. And if you're Giannis, if I'm a superstar, I don't want to be the third guy because LeBron will have the ball in his hands. He'll be running the point, and he'll get his 20-plus points a game. AD is more skilled offensively than Giannis, so he can shoot the basketball, he can post up, he can do other things. Where would Giannis fit in this? Now, you could say, well, Dwayne Wade wasn't a shooter, you know, and Bosh became the third guy because he could shoot, so maybe that would be AD. But that was a different NBA. The three-pointer was not as important back when LeBron and D-Wade played together in Miami. Now, with the three ball as it is, I think because Giannis can't shoot, he could easily become that third guy and really be like a glorified role player. Kyrie Irving was the second guy in Cleveland to LeBron because he could shoot, though. And so Giannis would be great with the Lakers in transition. And defensively, I mean, he'd be a terror. But in the half court, I could kind of see him getting lost. So I think for him, if I don't stay in Milwaukee, I'm looking at Miami, where he could just go fit in and you got shooters you could place around him. I'm looking at maybe a trade to Golden State or even a trade to Philadelphia. Because if he's a free agent and he wants to go to Philadelphia, he'll be able to push a sign and trade somewhere. And if Philly doesn't win the East this year, they may be ready to go in a different direction. And maybe you, if you're Milwaukee, you can get Ben Simmons for Giannis. And then Philly tries to pair him with Embiid. So I don't think it'll happen. But look, Kevin Durant went to Golden State, 73-win team. So nothing's impossible. But I would be shocked if Giannis went and joined the Lakers with LeBron and AD.
Well, Skip, he took all my points, so I'm going to let you take it because that's exactly what I was going to say. I would say no. I wouldn't bet against it because KD went. But, hey, go ahead. I'll let you go.
I do not doubt this is in the works. And I don't think it's on the Lakers' radar. I think it's on LeBron James' radar.
Right.
LeBron James needs AD and Giannis to catch Michael Jordan. That's what's about to happen. I do not doubt it 1 second because he needs to get to six so he can say, I'm 6-6. Everybody's supposed to forget about the second six. Yeah. And Jordan was, no, you're not going to get to seven. 6-6. But obviously Jordan was 6-0 with six finals MVPs. It's over, but LeBron will be able to make the case if he could ever get Giannis to come. Also, it would take both of those guys to put LeBron over the top just to get to six. And the point of this is, I think Giannis also needs LeBron and AD. To me, Giannis has shown himself to be nothing but a 1A. He cannot lead a team by himself to a title, nor could LeBron in Cleveland, obviously. But even though a very good team was around Giannis the last 2 years in Milwaukee, it still won't work unless he can rise and shine in playoff situations. And we see that he's flawed. He doesn't have a mid-range game. And you can shut him down. He's terrible at the free throw line. But if you pair him, as Chris just pointed out, with LeBron and AD, whew, you could figure that out quickly. And as LeBron ages up to, what is he now, 36?
He'd be 36 in
December. Okay, so as he goes 37, 38, if he had Giannis and AD, he could play more pure point guard
right.
And distribute, and it would work, and maybe they would get to, or he would get to six championships.
Ain't no maybe. Yeah. You know good well if he got Giannis, AD, and LeBron,
okay,
it's
well,
over.
Maybe he's got one eye on Brooklyn because all of a sudden it's KD, Kyrie, and who knows, maybe James Harden, and then we would have East meets West.
First of all, how you going to have KD on a max contract, Kyrie on a max contract, James Harden on a max contract, and what you call him on a max contract?
Okay, I ask you the same question about the Lakers, but somehow the capology works because it's the LeBron rules. It's LeBron rights.
What did KD do? If you notice, KD was signing 1-1, and he was taking $9 million, $8 million less each contract, so therefore you could keep Steph got that max deal, so you were able to keep everybody at bay.
Okay.
That's what we'd be willing to do.
Okay.
LeBron got one more year, Skip, and then he on the option. So we got two options. LeBron might be saying, okay, well, I'm supposed to make like 40 mil.
So my final point before I throw it back to Chris Broussard is somewhere Michael Jordan is laughing at this because this would have been the last thing that he would have tried to pull off when he played.
Well, I'm over here laughing at him signing Gordon Hayward 4 years, 120. So there are a lot of people laughing at him right now, aren't they, Chris?
Well, I'm going to leave. That's just a topic for another day.
Yep.
I'll say this. Let's say hypothetically this were to happen and LeBron does get to six wins in the finals. He's 6-6. To me, the most impressive part of that in the argument with Jordan as far as the GOAT would be now LeBron would be, you'd have to say, okay, he won six. And granted, he wasn't undefeated like MJ, but he got to 12. Like, that is incredible. That, to me, would be more of an argument in the GOAT debate than just the six championships. Because if we look at the championships, getting there with Giannis and AD, like, the one thing Jordan's always going to have over LeBron is he didn't have these tailor-made teams. Like, LeBron went and kind of made tailor-made teams to win his championships, whereas Jordan just kind of took what was with him and won it. And so I think you could use that argument if he wins it with Giannis and AD. But the 12 trips to the finals, even though he only won six, that would be incredibly impressive.
Wait a second. In those six losses, I'm thinking swept once, swept twice, gentlemen swept another time, gentlemen swept by the Spurs by a record finals margin. Do you want me to keep going? There's some epic fails in there.
And we're going to have... We're going to get to seven. We're going to be seven titles. So we're going to be 7-6. That's 13 titles in like 20 years with 40,000 points, 10,000 assists, 10,000 rebounds. How many all-NBA teams? How many all-stars?
What am I supposed to do with the 2011 finals, the all-time epic fail where
do what you
two
want to
games
do with
to
them.
Win?
We still to go.
Two games to one and you blow 4, 5, and 6 with the all-time meltdown by a superstar?
You can do what you want with 2007, 2011, 2014. 2017, 2018, whatever. We still going to be the GOAT.
Yep. Well, you need Giannis. So, Giannis,
come on now. No. Yeah. We don't need him.
Yes,
we would like to have him.
Yeah.
But we don't need him.
Yeah. I think that trio with the Lakers, it would be better than if you had Harden, KD, and Kyrie.
We'd blow the doors off.
It would essentially be the same thing. It's a chemistry experiment.
No. But we got a true point guard. We have a true point guard that knows how to distribute the ball. So that's the difference.
Okay, but who would have the best player on the floor?
But Giannis can't shoot. That's the challenge.
Yep.
But we got some people. Don't worry about that shooting. We know how to put Giannis in position to thrive.
Wait, who would have the most nuclear weapon? I think Brooklyn would.
First of all,
Kevin Durant's the best player on the planet.
Chris, I'm sorry that you have to hear this, but I ask you to pray. When you go to church on Sunday, will you pray for Chris to get this demon out of his soul for talking that foolishness?
Well,
KD
outplay LeBron back-to-back finals. I don't know. Maybe I dreamed that.
So did LeBron outplay KD? Did LeBron ever outplay KD?
We're going to have to wait and see how this one plays out.
When he was a baby.
We will see with this baby. No mercy. During last night's loss to the Rams, Tom Brady finished with 216 passing yards on a season low, 4.5 yards per attempt, and also threw two interceptions, including one on the Bucs' final drive when they had a chance to tie or take the lead. The game gave the 43-year-old Brady his third loss in primetime this season and dropped the Buccaneers to sixth place in the NFC. So, Shannon, give Tom Brady a letter grade for his performance last night.
About to give him a grade so low, you need a crane to pull it up.
Really?
Yep. You know what he getting. And what he deserves. I am giving it to him. He earned this one.
Huh.
Yes, he earned this F.
Oh, I thought you were going to give him a G.
Nah. He should get X-rated. Because I'm sorry I had to see this. I shouldn't have to see this, Skip.
Really?
That was pathetic last night. And you know it. And I'm gonna see how you wiggle your way out of this with some pro football focus. Sis, you love that. So, Skip, 22 incompletions. Only 216 yards on 48 pass attempts, as Jenny mentioned, like 4.2 yards per attempt, which is horrible. He was 1-for-9 with 2 interceptions on passes 15 yards down the field, but he can throw it down the field. He was 0-for-6 with 2 INTs with plays 20 yards down the field. And he can't get anything but that. Skip, that was an awful performance. Hell, I thought it was a rock skipping contest, the way he was bouncing balls to AB, Chris Godwin and Mike Evans. I'm like, is that the way they do now in the NFL? They change the rules every year. So he would be good at that. Skip, you saw that. It was so much I couldn't even put all the bad throws into one reel. But you best believe I got it coming. I got me a little blooper reel now. So every time you call for the LeBron blooper reel, I'm going to call for this Tom Brady blooper. Skip, he was bad. He's played poor the last month. You know that. He's played bad for a month now.
Wait, did Brady try to inbounds the ball and hit the back of the backboard?
Whoa. We're not talking about Brady. Yes. We're going to stay on this. Let me tell you what he did. He threw the ball, caught it again, and tried to throw another one.
I thought that was slick.
I know that was slick. Who he fooled? Because as soon as he threw the ball forward, the referee had the flag already throwing it up
in
there.
I've never seen anybody do that before. That was goat.
Because they know you're not supposed to do that.
My turn for some objectivity here, and I'm going to be really cold, hard, objective on this performance last night.
Yeah, let's see you try.
Okay. In the first half, I'm going to give Tom Brady an A because he was wheeling and he was dealing. in the second half, and I'm going to wait the second half a little more. Obviously, it's the second half. I'm going to give him a C minus. So I will average that grade out to a C plus for Tom Brady, because in the first half, he put them ahead with a masterpiece of a drive, 14-7. If we could quickly see these throws, these are third down throws in this first drive. The first one goes third and six at the 36. This is mid-second quarter, and he just whips it out to Cameron Brake. These are long third down conversions. Next one's third and nine from the 44. And here he goes again to Cameron Brate. That is a sweet throw. Now we got a third and eight. Look at little Scotty Miller. Had one sighting. That is a rocket shot. And the safety is early. Pass interference. That was 25 yards right there. And he caps it off with another bullet out route to Mike Evans on Jalen Ramsey. Gets it down to the two-yard line. And you just gave him an F. And just for that drive alone, how could you give him an F?
Hey, Jim, can you do me a favor? Jim, drop that track right quick for me right quick. That incompletion track. Yeah. Mm. You know, this is the incompletion track. Yeah. Because I think, if I'm not mistaken, this was the first half. Mm-hmm. This was the first half. Am I correct?
Yeah, that was actually a good throw.
It was not.
Mike Evans looked
look at this right
way.
Here. He picks the wrong side. Mm-hmm. The safety is over the top. Mm-hmm. He should have came to AB because AB was open at the bottom. Okay. Bloop, that was him right there. Was that him? Mm.
That wasn't that bad of a throw.
What about
the throw
this?
Was right on the money, actually.
What is that? So what did he get
hit,
for that?
He got hit and his arm went sideways.
What do you got for that?
Sideways out of his hands.
And what about this one? Okay, what happened with this one?
I appreciate that.
What happened with this one?
Okay, well, that's the game ender, and he's trying to force the ball to Cameron Brake.
I don't know what he was trying to do, but I know what he did.
So, mid-fourth quarter, would you believe that Tom Brady went on a drive that covered 44 yards in seven plays with a touchdown pass to Chris Godwin that ended it and tied the game at 24-all? And the Hall of Famer across from me gave him an F. He tied the game at 24-all, mid-fourth quarter. You gave him an F.
Yes, hold on.
Wait a second. I think I'm speaking
go ahead.
And he did it against the defense that has allowed the fewest yards in the league, that has the best cornerback tandem in the league. And the safety valve he used to have in little James White was Leonard Fournette last night, and he threw him three balls, and he dropped all three of them. And you gave him an F with three drops.
Did you know in the third quarter, Tom Brady had four drives in the third quarter?
He was terrible in the third quarter.
I think I'm speaking now. Thank you. Tom Brady had four drives in the third quarter for 8 yards. Is that good? Mm. Is that good?
So he was down his best offensive line, Allie Marpet, and then he lost the backup center to start the last drive. Way to go.
Hold on. Was A.B.
F. Give him an F.
I just want to know, was A.B. in attendance?
Mm.
What about Mike Evans? Was he there?
Yeah.
What about Chris Godwin?
Mm-hmm.
Was Rob Gronkowski, the GOAT tight end?
Yeah.
What about Cameron Brate?
Yeah.
So he had all those weapons.
What about Devin White? What about Levante David?
No, what about them?
Were they in attendance?
Time out.
Wait, was Shaq Barrett in attendance? He led the league in sacks last year. Did they touch Jared Goff?
Hold on.
Did they?
Hold on. When I mentioned the defense with Coach Belichick, you say that nothing. So he doesn't need a defense. Huh. Now he needs a defense?
Where was Todd Bowles blitzing? They never touched Jared Goff the whole night. Tom Brady got the hell knocked out of him in the third quarter.
I noticed when Tom Brady plays bad, it's everybody else's fault except Tom Brady.
Did you like the way the defense played last night? What would you give the defense?
What did you give Tom Brady?
Would you give him like a B?
What would you give Tom
Brady? I'd give the defense an F.
So the defense played worse than Tom Brady?
That they allowed Jared Goff to come within one completion of the all-time Monday Night Football record.
Hold on.
Are you kidding?
Think about Tom Brady, Skip. 48 attempts for barely 200 yards?
Well, against that defense and those cornerbacks? Are you kidding me?
Hold on. No. That's the GOAT. He the GOAT.
Gave him an F.
He deserved it. I didn't give it to him. He earned it. He deserved it.
No mercy.
DeMarcus Cousins has reached a one-year deal with the Houston Rockets for the veterans minimum. Cousins missed all of last year because of a torn ACL after signing with the Lakers, and he missed significant time before that due to a ruptured Achilles in New Orleans and a torn quad in Golden State. For Houston, signing the big man is a stark departure from last year when 6'5" P.J. Tucker played center in the second half of the season. So, Shannon, what was your reaction when you heard the news?
Good for him. Skip, I just hope he can get back 80% of what he was. Skip, there was a time that there was a serious discussion. Anthony Davis or Boogie Cousins.
I agree.
I went with AD because he was better on the defensive end.
Mm-hmm.
But offensively, Boogie could do it all.
Mm-hmm.
Score, rebound, triple-dub. I'm talking about 50, 20, 10 triple-dubs.
Mm-hmm.
He was special. And injuries have robbed him of a very promising career. Mm-hmm. I just hope I would love to see him come all the way back, Skip. But if he can just get back to 80% of what Boogie once was, he would be unbelievable.
I said when he was at Kentucky, he would be a better player than John Wall. A lot of people laughed at me, and I stand by that because he is a career 21 and 11. And I'm with you. This could be a good spot for him. I still believe deep down that he's got an all-star caliber year mm-hmm. left in that body if his legs will hold up, yes. and I don't know if they will. But maybe this is the place to start over and start slowly but surely coming back because he is a huge talent.
Because he was, Skip, he was unbelievable. Mm-hmm. Remember when he paired up with AD down and he got injured? They were doing it. And I just hope he can just come back, Skip.
Yeah, I know he can be a little crazy sometimes, but he's a good guy.
Yeah. He can play. He can play.
So true. Just hope Cousins.
Come on, Boogie.
At this point, yeah, it would be a great story. That is it for Undisputed Today. Good stuff today, guys. We're back at the same time tomorrow morning, 9:30 a.m. Eastern. The Herd is on right after us, per usual. What are you saying over there, Shannon? We got to go. Have a good day.